was a thing of beauty. That was fantastic. So the Badgers get a big win last night. Bucks got a big win by 40. They reached some ridiculous margin. And, I tweeted it out. I said, look, and everybody said, well, this is a beatdown. And I said, I agree with you. But as long as you have Steph Curry, I don't feel safe. I just don't. Well, they ended up with a 20 point win last night, something like that, a 19 point win, 118, 199. And the Bucks walk away with a victory. And that was an emphatic victory. That was one of those, everybody's talking about Golden State. Everybody's talking about Brooklyn. Everybody's talking about the Bulls. And we're the defending champs. And, oh, by the way, here we are. And pow, 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 pow. And they came out swinging last night. And they let them creep back into it like all NBA teams do. There's always a run in somebody. But the Bucks fended them off. Curry last night only with 12 points. Giannis 30, dropping 30 on him with 12 boards and 11 assists, triple-double last night for the big guy. And a solid night last night. So in the realm of hardwood, it was a good night throughout the state of Wisconsin. So good stuff there for the Wisconsin Badgers and good stuff for the Milwaukee Bucks. So they walk away with a win last night. So today we are we're loaded. We're loaded today. We have got Andrew Brrandt going to join us a little less than an hour from now. We're going to talk with him and see if he has changed his mind at all about Aaron Rodgers leaving Green Bay, and also about the thought of this team getting all these guys back and how it is to work a roster and with the new rules and such. We're going to talk Zach Heilprin, sports director at The Zone in Madison. He's going to join us, and we're going to talk some Badger basketball. Got to talk about that win last night and what that means for the program this season, because the program's been through some really high highs. Not like this was some kind of some monumental moment when it comes to the program, but for the season, yes. A little bit of revenge, taste sweet last night, good stuff. And then the sauce is going to join us. A.J. Dillon, running back for the Green Bay Packers. The sauce is going to be here live on the air with us, and we're going to talk with him, how he's feeling, get the sense as to what that team's thinking, and with all these guys coming back, and then to close it out, none other than our man out of the pen. We need like theme music because Mike's our closer. We need like some kind of badass Hell's Bells theme music or something because Mike's closing it out. And then Mike Clemens coming out of it's like, you know, ladies and gentlemen, now coming to the mound, Mike Clemens. And then bam, the door kicks open and then Clem comes walking through. Now he's usually wearing black Skechers and white socks, but that's okay because he's the closer. That's what he is. So maybe we throw in some music for Mike, but Mike is going to join us as well. So we're loaded today. Gonna have AJ Dillon on with us. People are excited about that super wild card weekend, the impact of some of these games that are about to be played, the pick. If you have to go with the upset, what is the more likely upset, the Philadelphia Eagles over the Tampa Bay Buccaneers or the Pittsburgh Steelers over the Kansas City Chiefs? If you got to pick one, what would it be? I was watching this morning, and they were talking more about it. Is it even possible for Pittsburgh to upset Kansas City? And I think it is. But I thought, what's the more likely upset? Ben, we know that you have been all Eagles all day. I've been listening to the mornings to the point where you're kind of like sandpaper underwear to Rowdy. Because you were starting to annoy the hell out of him. You know, you were irritating him, man. Which was great. I know, but it was great.
It's just a Friday.
It was great. So, by the way, Trent Williams for the San Francisco 49ers expected to come back. That big left tackle for the San Francisco 49ers. Missed last week's game against the Rams, but he is expected to come back and be a part of that team as they go up against the Cowboys. That's a big get back for that offensive line. So who is more likely to pull the upset? The Eagles over the Bucks, as the Bucks get Leonard Fournette and some of the injured back, or is it going to be Big Ben and Kansas City? You can also choose both or neither. You can go in that direction as well. I'll let you go there. But who could pull the, by the way, John right away says, Eagles. Eagles going to pull the upset. So you got another Eagles fan with you. Just saying. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to hit us up, feel free to go ahead and do it. Again, 877-867-1670. John says the Bucs are banged up, and they are, but they're getting players back. They're going to be getting players back. Peter says, can't wait for AJ. The sound is back. I think everybody's got sound now over on the Bud Light live stream, right? Brett says San Francisco over Dallas. And if you got questions, by the way, for Quadzilla, bring them, which Nathan already said, which ask AJ which quad is his favorite. the Quadzilla or the Quad Father? I thought you meant which quad, like looking down at his legs. Which one does he favor? Oh, I like this right one. It's more shapely. I trim it more. Oh, my goodness. Jeremy, right out of the chute today, says, all this talk about next season just irks me. My ass is chapped, unit. Why do people insist on talking about Aaron Rodgers not being here anymore? I think he's enjoying his time here in Green Bay, and I think he's going to stay. People need to shut up, worry about the now, win a championship, hoist the trophy, and then we'll worry about next season. That's Jeremy. Jeremy, you to me. I think it's just it's just because it's pertinent. You know, I mean, every week Aaron Rodgers gives you glimpses into what he's thinking by going on Pat McAfee, and everything that he says is pretty much broken down. And by the way, we have not seen this level of concern for one player's words. There's, and I said this the other day, there's only two players in the NFL. There's two people in the NFL. Short of Roger Goodell as the commissioner, there's two people in the NFL that really carry a lot of weight. One is Tom Brady, the other is Aaron Rodgers. And I would venture a guess at this point, because Tom Brady isn't on a show every week that is being dissected the way the Pat McAfee show is for Aaron Rodgers. So I would say at this point, Aaron Rodgers got a coach fired. That's how strong Aaron Rodgers is. He got a coach fired. Joe Judge was hanging on by a thread. Joe Judge was that guy. He's on the edge of the cliff. His fingers are over the edge of the cliff, right? And his body's hanging there, and he's kicking his legs, and he's starting to pull himself back up. And I'm going to hang on in New York. Oh, my God. They let Gettleman's going to retire. Okay, I get a chance to wow the new general manager. Here we go. And he starts to pull his head up, and there's Aaron Rodgers at the top of the cliff and just takes his foot and taps him in the forehead and kicks him over. That was Aaron Rodgers. Think he's a bum. That was Aaron Rodgers when it came to Joe Judge. Talking about that infamous run the inverted wishbone with your jumbo package deep in your own territory so you can give your punter more room. Yeah. Yeah, there you go. There you go. His words were, hey, Matt, call that and see what happens. In other words, what a dumbass move. And that's when the Mara family went, oh, my God. Our head coach is being ridiculed by Aaron Rodgers. This clown has to go. In the meantime, Joe Judge walking around down in the tunnel. I'm Joe Judge. We're going to win next year. I'm telling you right now. And he's pounding desks, and he's got his bravado, even though we all know he's pretty much coneyless. I'm going to win. Where I hung on. I'm the head coach. And it, what? Oh, crap. Okay. Well, I got to go pack up. I got to go. There you go. Oh. By the way, Ross says, and stealing my calling card, Ross the Sauce. He says, go back to the mayor of Door County. Ross, I'm telling you, I have to be honest with you, Ross. And I love you like a third cousin. You know that, right? The fact that you're over on the Bud Light live stream, you're watching the show, you're there, you're a part of the program, you're typing, you're taking the time to listen, you're taking the time to interact with the program. I love it. Absolutely love it. Love chatting with you guys each and every day. Love seeing it each and every day, right? But I'm going to tell you, Ross, right now, right here, and I'm going to look you straight in the eye, okay? I never heard of Ross the Sauce before you just said it. AJ Dillon, though, I think we've all heard of. So while your domain name may have been there first, it was never taken to the next level until AJ Dillon and Quadzilla grabbed the sauce and took it over. I love you like a third cousin, But I'm sorry. Can't happen. There you go. Just so you know. 877-867-1670. Glad to have you on board today. Hey, we are brought to you by our friends at Bud Light, the official beer sponsor of the Bill Michaels Sports Talk Network. Thanks to Bud Light. We had a great time last night down at the Broad Stop. Oh, my God. I'll tell you this. Now, we're going to be on the air in Milwaukee come Monday. We are making our triumphant return back to Milwaukee after a lot of finagling. So when we do the huddles, other than people that listen to the show on the app or people that listen to the show via the live stream, we don't get to the mass audience to say, hey, here we come. There's some local advertising that's done by Budweiser, but we don't get, the crowds are good. They're not great. Last night at the Brrandt Stop, people turned out. I was stunned. I was thrilled. I was appreciative, but I was stunned. That bar was full last night. When normally, I mean, even when we've been on the air in Milwaukee, it hasn't always been full, but the bar was full last night. People turned out, and they turned out to listen to the program. And that is really bear country. On the edge of Illinois, just like going to La Crosse or going up to Eau Claire, you get into those areas where you start to cross over, you start to get some purple jerseys that invade that area. You get a lot of Bears fans down there. As a matter of fact, they have more Bears memorabilia in the Brrandt Stop than they do Packers memorabilia, okay? But I get to the Brrandt Stop last night, pretty crowded. And I, by crowded, I mean around the bar, because you never fill the venue because the venue is a music venue. So we get there last night, set up. There's probably 15, 20 people there, which is a good amount of people for what they normally have. By the end of the show, there had to be 100 people in there, 150 people in there. And if there was one, there was 20 that came in and said, we've been waiting for you to come down here further. We've been waiting for the Brrandt Stop. We've been waiting for you. It's been great. We're glad to hear you coming back on in Milwaukee. Wanted to come out and see the show and watch the Badger game and watch the Bucks game. It was a hell of a night last night. It was a lot of fun. So to everybody that came out to the Brrandt Stop last night, thanks for swinging by. Thanks to Bud Light, buying a couple of beverages last evening. Thanks to them for being a part of the program, as always. Good night last night. Fun stuff. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. We're going to step away, take a quick break. We're going to come back. And when we do, we're going to get back into this Super Wild Card weekend. Hang in there. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show. It's all coming up right after this.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Thank you. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back to the program. Glad you're with us. We were down the Brrandt stop last night. Greg says the Brrandt stop, fib tourist stop. Nah, it's not a really, I mean, it's a tourist stop, yeah, but it's, you get a good mix in there. I'm not saying it's Bears country. I'm saying you're on the fringe. So, no, it's quite a few Bears fans were in there last night. Quite a few. I mean, there was more Packers fans in there than there were Bears, but it's when you start to get the crossover. There's a lot of people that have moved from Chicago and moved from Illinois that have moved into Kenosha and Racine County. Just look at the population that's had the explosion there as of late. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to chime in, do it. Which team is most likely to garner the upset this weekend? Which team is most likely? I don't think San Francisco, if they would beat the Cowboys, that's an upset. I just don't. I think San Francisco can go toe-to-toe with them. I think San Francisco is a better team. I think the Eagles beating the Buccaneers or the Steelers beating the Chiefs, those to me, that would be the upsets. Which is more likely? Because you've got an Eagles run game that's very solid against a very solid, and they're getting Jason Pierre-Paul back too, the Buccaneers are on that front four. They've got a really staunch front, albeit as of late, they haven't necessarily played that well. But which one is more likely to garner the upset? Which one's more likely to garner the upset? 877-867-1670. Hit us up. By the way, speaking of the 49ers, Niners defensive end Nick Bosa, I don't know if you heard him say this, but the Dallas Cowboys are boasting the top pair of offensive tackles. That's what they say. Tyron Smith, Lyle Collins, those are the two. They're a man. Bosa said yesterday, I think they're both solid players. Obviously, Tyron's had a Hall of Fame career, and him and 49ers Trent Williams have been the best tackles in the league for a long time, but they're definitely beatable. There's tape on them getting beat, and we're trying to do the same. They've definitely been in and out of the lineup a lot this year and the past year, so the game plan is to make them work. Bosa, some strong words. And, hey, look, these guys are good. Don't overlook us. They're beatable. We can beat these guys. It's a little billboard fodder right there. Something to watch, just something to pay attention to. Something to watch coming up tomorrow or coming up on Sunday. There you go. So if you get into the actual picks and you start to look at the games coming up this weekend, get into the Eagles. Now, the Buccaneers, their ability to come back from injury, the biggest variable for this game. Lavonte David, Shaq Barrett, Jason Pierre-Paul, and Leonard Fournette all going to see Sunday. We assume. Will they look better? If the team continues on, will they look good? Will they look tired, fatigued, whatever? We'll have to wait and see. I like the Eagles to keep it close. Jalen Hurts, the run game, the ability to scramble. And that Bucs defense, we talked about this last night, they're kind of lit on a little bit of a reputation right now. Tampa's 16th in rush defense since week 9, a stretch in which Philly has fielded one of the league's most dynamic ground games at that point in time. This could be a 7-possession game for each team when you start to look at the possession chart as where they go. And I don't know if the Bucs are going to just move it down the field, no questions asked. So we'll see. But can Jalen Hurts give him a little bit of magic, the run game, grind on him a little bit, and can they pull that upset? Can that happen? In the meantime, Patrick Mahomes said after the regular season finale that the Chiefs haven't had that complete game yet. Can they do that against Pittsburgh? Because remember, Mahomes left the game against Pittsburgh leading 33-3 with 12 minutes left. They had a good game. They played well. And he says they haven't played a complete game yet. And Big Ben, in the meantime, is like, we're not even supposed to be here. We're just going to go have fun. Let it all hang out. Now, I don't think, if I know Mike Tomlin, Mike Tomlin's not going to say, hey, guys, go have fun. You're not expected to win. Go let it all hang out. Now, he's not going to say that. He's going to say we're here for a reason. We earned it. We're here for a reason. I went to bed on Sunday night. Didn't watch the rest of that game because I knew we had work to do come Monday morning. Come Monday morning, we got our work in. If we all play the way we're capable of playing, with the pressure we plan on putting on Mahomes, we can get some to him, cause a turnover or two, we're in this thing. We're going to win this game. We're going to do what we do, you know, on and on and on, and get guys fired up. And then after that, the kickoff comes and guys get hit, and then all of a sudden you realize what you really are. I mean, the Kansas City Chiefs are a more talented team. But will it be a blowout? Could some turnovers decide it? I'm thinking more that the Kansas City Chiefs are just that damn good, and they're probably going to be hell out of Pittsburgh. But can Pittsburgh get the win? Can they get the upset? Pick one, or both, for that matter. I don't care. Ben, I know you're hoping for an Eagles upset. What? You tell me what has to be key in this game for the Eagles to get the win over the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Ugh, it's the most cliche Tom Brady thing ever. But everyone always says you got to get him off his spot and get pressure in the inside without blitzing. And that's going to be the key. The weather's going to be horrible, though. So I'm kind of just rooting for a slot fest.
Is it really? I haven't even looked. I
know inside the game.
They've got that goofy thing that's passing us right now. It's off to the west. And I don't know if Madison's getting flurries. Are you getting any snow out there right now?
Right now, I could not tell you. I don't really see the light of day when I'm in here. However, I think we are.
Okay, later. So I know that Madison and the western portion of the state, we'll just say, is getting some snow, getting some flurries as this, whatever this massive ball of bleck is, it's going to go down and around Wisconsin, down and around like Indiana, Kentucky, maybe glimpsing into Ohio a little bit, but then it's going to come back up. As it goes down, it's going to be this ball of wet death, I guess. And it's supposed to make life miserable all the way down the East Coast, all the way down south to the rains, all the way north. They're supposed to have some kind of massive snowstorm or something because they're talking about the game for Buffalo and the game with New England and Buffalo being just another breezy, blowy, blustery snowfest, which I love. I love it this time of year. So they're talking about that game having all kinds of weather. So that's what's traveling down and around and going to be coming back up the eastern portion of the country as we, thank God, are going to escape that. I love the weather when all this stuff is melting and I can finally see some grass in my yard. Anyway, neither here nor there, but they're going to have weather. So there's going to be some weather on the East Coast. I'm excited about that. This is where I wish all teams were playing outside, but you know, we're going to have some dome games. I get it. It is what it is, but I'm looking forward to that. Looking forward to the blech. It's going to be on the East Coast. So a weather game, sloppy game. Hey, don't forget. I mean, Tom Brady's not free from throwing an interception here or there. There's been some games that he has not looked good. He's still thrown some picks, and they've been able to overcome it. So it's not like Tom Brady's not up for throwing a pick or two or turning the ball over every now and then. He can do, like you said, you get him off his mark, get him a little bit rattled, and get up on him a little bit. You can beat up on that team a little bit. So we'll see. But I'm looking forward to that. What's supposed to be like a black snow game. I was watching, what was it? Al Roker, I think, And Al Roker's like, well, batting down the hat. Sunday night into Monday morning is supposed to be just awful. It's like end of the world. And anytime they get more than 3 inches of snow on the East Coast, it's like, you know, the worst thing to ever happen to the world, and everything's coming to an end because the East Coast is the only thing that matters. But, yeah, they're supposed to have some snow in that area. It is classified, as Kim says, as an Alberta clipper. It's usually powder and fast moving. All right. There you go. We've got a meteorologist among us. I'm happy about that. This one's from Kevin. Says, I got a funny feeling that 6 out of the 8 road teams win this weekend. That is my upset. Boy, that would be an upset. That would be an upset. And Brett wants to know, can Philly somehow bring in Nick Foles by Sunday?
So that's the hope. However, I don't find it realistic.
Yep.
Because Doug Peterson might go to Chicago and just keep him there. It's okay, though. Happen. We have our backup. We have Gardner Minshew.
Well, you got the stash.
And the bomber jacket, all of it.
The stash, the bomber jacket, and somewhere in the background, there's probably porn music playing. Without a doubt.
Bill, weather for Sunday, 23-mile-an-hour winds, thunderstorms in Tampa.
Oh, that's awesome.
So the ideal scenario is Brady can't even throw the football. However, he might deflate them enough so he could get a grip.
Right. Couple pounds out of the football, you're good to go. Then they would rely on Leonard Fournette. And whether or not he can carry the load, we'll have to wait and see. He's coming back from injury. A lot of teams getting guys back. Do you like this new rule where you can get guys back? I mean, certainly it benefits the Green Bay Packers. Don't get me wrong.
I love it.
I do too.
Especially in a year where teams have played shorthanded so often, given everything. I love it.
Yep. I love the fact that a lot of these guys who have an opportunity to come back can play in the postseason and can play for a championship, because that's what you work your ass up for all offseason, all through the summer. When you get into training camp, you're sweating, you're nasty, and then you finally get a chance to play in your season. You go down with an injury, what would normally be the end of your season, but now you get a chance to come back and contribute to your team and go after what it ultimately is you wanted, and that's the ring. So I love it. This is so much good. I love the fact that only one team gets the bye. I love the fact that we got Super Wild Card Weekend. They're dragging it over into Monday. I love it that we got Saturday, Sunday, Monday games. I love everything about it. More football, the better. 877-867-1670. And Brian's right. It's going to help out Tennessee as well. No doubt. Getting Derrick Henry back is huge. Absolutely. We're going to step out, take a quick break, come back. A lot more of the Bill Michaels Show coming up right after this.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Gina Della from Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin with today's top 10 reasons to see PellaWI.com now. Number 10.
My Pella team installs year-round.
Number 9.
Every one of our installers is Pella certified to ensure your complete satisfaction.
Number 8.
My Pella team completes installations in as little as one day.
Number 7 through 5.
A 2020 survey rated Pella Windows number 1 for highest value, highest quality, and most preferred by Green Bay and Milwaukee homeowners.
Numbers 4 and 3.
Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin has 6 lines to fit your style and financing to fit any budget.
Number 2.
Now Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin's featured offer gives you 5 years no interest plus 5 months no payment.
And the number 1 reason to see PellaWI.com now.
These offers end January 31st.
Set your free consultation today at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply. See show for details.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. We'll be right back. Bill Michaels will resume in 4 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back. Glad to have you. Bill Michaels Show, we continue on. Hopefully you're in enjoying your Friday, getting you into the Super Wild Card weekend. Good stuff. A lot of good stuff today, as a matter of fact. Enjoying the day. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to chime in, do it. I'm Bill Michaels, Ben Kenny producing the program. By the way, for all of you that are wondering, and yes, we finally launched it, in case you didn't know, you can find us over on Spotify. You can find us on iTunes. You can find us on the Google Podcasts. We got the podcast out. You just got to search The Bill Michaels Show. Simple. Just The Bill Michaels, M-I-C-H-A-E-L-S, show. You can take us anywhere, anytime, any place. Okay? So if you're in the car and you want to listen to something over again, you can't. If you're jogging, maybe you're working out in the gym, you can't. I don't know if we're the best for bow-bow time, but if you want to put us on in the background, keep your mind on something, keep you from, you know, hitting the road a little too soon, you can do that as well. Whatever. We're good to go.
I mean, we have some Does Viagra Keep You Warm talk in the last best stuff.
Correct.
I think that plays.
That does play. You're right. Little Viagra chatter. That's always good. Always makes the show better. 877-867-1670. Let's see here. This one is from Max. Max says, hey, unit, love having you come back on in Milwaukee. He says, what are your thoughts if the Green Bay Packers should get Mike McCarthy? And we've talked about this almost ad nauseum. And we're going to talk a lot about it next week, I'm sure. When it comes to Mike McCarthy coming back, and I've said this before, I think there's an anxiety from fans and maybe, if you want to say, a little bit from Rodgers. Because Rodgers, we know that butting heads prior to Mike McCarthy's firing, that there was something going on there, right? So I would assume fans don't want to get beat by the guy that used to be here. And for fans that wanted Mike out so bad, the offense sucks. He can't motivate. He's not doing this. He's terrible. He hung on to assistant coaches too long. For all the people that wanted Mike fired, you're seething. You want to beat him. You want to beat him because you don't want that guy to come back into your house and beat your new coach who's been so successful or beat your quarterback who you chose over Mike McCarthy, right? Right. So there's that anxiety. Other than that, think of a reason why you'd want to beat Mike McCarthy. Other than just part of the Cowboys, I mean, that's an obvious. But beyond that, who cares? Right? Who cares? Mike McCarthy didn't do anything to anybody. He helped bring a title back to Titletown. He's a part of that. He's forever attached in the lore of the Green Bay Packers. He was a good guy. I mean, short of the altercation he had with the official at the high school basketball game, he didn't have any problems in the community. Him and his wife did a lot for Children's Hospital and certain hospitals in the state of Wisconsin. I mean, they did a lot of good things here. There's no reason to dislike Mike McCarthy. None. But there are some who were very vocal. And whenever anything goes wrong, it's fire the head coach. When things are good, they're crickets. You know, like all the Joe Barry haters, first 2 weeks, they were out in force, man. This is stupid, terrible choice. And then all of a sudden, defense got good. You went, oh, okay. We actually did a topic on this show that said, do we owe Joe Barry an apology? And I said, we have to wait and see. But everybody was quiet. Nobody said yes, but nobody came on and said no. All of the people that chirp, that say, I told you so, all the I told you so Twitter muscle people, they all came out of the woodwork after the defense started playing poorly. When they shut out Russell Wilson, there was nothing. It was silence. It was crickets. And when they gave up the loss to the Vikings and then 30-plus from pretty much then on out, then it was, wow, I told you Joe Barry sucks. No, you didn't. You said it at the beginning of the season. And then when things started going well, you shut up. You stand by your decision and you pontificate it continuously to the point that either you're going to either go down with that and hang on to it, or you're going to turn it around and you're going to go, maybe I was wrong. One of the two. Same thing with Mike McCarthy. Mike, when things were good, they were winning in spite of Mike McCarthy. When things were bad, they were losing because of Mike McCarthy. But Mike didn't do anything to anybody. 877-867-1670. Jake says, though, doesn't matter. Cowboys not going to get past the 49ers. That's a big game this weekend. Big game. Down to Jerry World. Remember, Jerry Jones kind of put the hat on him. Said, hey, Super Bowl, period. I don't have any other expectations. It's not a good season if we lose. From here on out, he said, it's not a good season if we lose. So that, you know, Now, that's what I expect Jerry to say. Jerry wants to hoist another trophy before he croaks off. And Jerry's not getting any younger. I mean, Jerry's not the young Jerry anymore. He's not running around with all the young women and everything. I'm sure the young women want to jump on the ship because he's got that big, giant yacht that he cruises around in. I'm sure that he could probably throw some epic parties, but he's kind of like the aging Hugh Hefner. He's probably not running around anymore. Or back into our Viagra discussion. One of the two. He's now having pillow fights and pajama parties with Mike McCarthy. So he knows his time's coming to an end. He's like, well, boy, I only got a couple opportunities here to give me another championship before I start to lose my damn mind. And after that, I'm not even eating brisket anymore. I'm just eating bread and calling it good, putting barbecue sauce on it. So we'll see what happens with Jerry, because Jerry just basically put the hat on him, said, hey, look, time to win. Got to do it now. 877-867-1670. Find us on Twitter at @Bill_Michaels. Find us on Facebook, The Bill Michaels Show, over on Facebook, Bill Michaels Show on YouTube, which, by the way, thanks to everybody. We continually get more and more and more people that subscribe and watch the program over on YouTube. That's fantastic. That is grown. We're well over 2,000 followers and 2,000 subscribers and viewers on YouTube now. But thanks to everybody that does that. YouTube.com/Bill Michaels, M-I-C-H-A-E-L-S, Bill Michaels Show. We're good to go. But you can find us on all the other platforms now as well. Coming up this next hour, coming up here in about 15 minutes, Andrew Brrandt, the Business of Sports podcast. Obviously, we're going to talk with him, part of the MMQB, and he was a former capologist, if you will, for the Green Bay Packers. Then we're going to talk with Zach Heilprin about an hour and 15 minutes from now. We're going to talk about that Badger win last night. Good win last night for the Badgers. Good win last night for the Bucks. And then in the last hour of the program, it's going to be the sauce. Quadzilla is going to join us live and in person. We're going to talk with him. Mike Clemens is going to join us. We got all kinds of stuff. All kinds of stuff. And Andrew Brrandt, we're going to talk with him about all these coaching hirings and firings as well, because I want to get into that with him too. So stay tuned. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show on a Friday, a super wild card weekend kind of day. Stay tuned. More of the Bill Michaels Show next.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Now, in Green Bay, here's Mike Clemens.
The Packers held another outdoor practice during the bye week. Seven players have returned from injuries, including veteran right tackle Billy Turner, linebacker Za'Darius Smith, and even outside linebacker Whitney Mercilus, who back in November was told his torn bicep was season-ending. Packers defensive coordinator Joe Barry.
He's been saying since, you know, the night that he got hurt, he's like, I'm going to be back. I'm coming back. I promise you I'm coming back. He's worked his tail off to get to where he's at. And yes, I was completely surprised that it was, you know, as early as today, but it was great to have him out there.
So the players will have the weekend off, but Packers offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett has three job interviews with the Jaguars, Broncos, and Chicago Bears about their head coaching openings.
When you're talking to people, it's not as much X's and O's as people would think. It's more just about kind of the person that you are, how you would lead the team, how you would handle the team. And it's been a great experience here because how we do it here is how I want to do it. And so it's kind of been a on-the-job training since I got here with Matt.
And I asked safety Adrian Amos if he's ever woke up on a Sunday morning during a bye week, restless to play any.
When I wake up, you know, because, you know, usually before a game, I wake up in a hotel. So I know how I'm waking up with my son screaming. So I know it's not game day. So I think this bye, you know, is good for our bodies. It's good for us learning the fundamentals, getting back to fundamentals. We can do extra stuff that you don't really get to do.
In Green Bay, I'm Mike Clemens on the Bill Michaels Show.
Welcome back to the program. Glad to have you. Thanks to Mike Clemens, our guy. Good stuff. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. Mike, by the way, brought to you by our friends out there at the Bay Motel Green Bay. BayMotelGreenBay.com. Go to BayMotelGreenBay.com for reservations. Quiet, cozy, comfortable, and don't forget they got the Bay Family Restaurant. Serving 7 days a week, home-style cooking. Go to BayMotelGreenBay.com. Anthony says, I think the upset is going to be the Eagles. I'm picking the Eagles to get the beat down of the Bucs. Tom Brady is no more. His crown will come off. It's time for Aaron Rodgers to take his rightful place, and the Eagles will help him do it. There you go. You got an Eagles fan alongside you, Ben. Somebody else that's believing in the green.
That scares me.
Yeah, I know. People are jumping on your bandwagon. I think we should have a logo, the Ben Kenny bandwagon. Just everybody just jumping on with Eagles fans.
There's nothing I want more than to get my bell rung at Lambeau next Sunday.
Here's the thing, and this is another ask. Do people hope that Brady gets knocked off and that the Packers don't have to face the Tampa Bay Buccaneers at any point in time because of the fear of Brady? Or is it that they believe that the Buccaneers just, it's time for the Buccaneers to get knocked off, that they just will get knocked off? You know what I mean? I don't necessarily think that. Look, the argument is everybody believes that the Packers are going to be the team to represent the NFC in the Super Bowl. I was watching this morning. I think it was Get Up, and everybody picked the Packers. Now there was many different choices in the AFC, but everybody picked the Packers because the Packers are getting healthy. The Packers are the best team. Rodgers is playing the best football. You know, all of that. So, but I get the sense for people that are kind of rooting for the Eagles and picking the Eagles in an upset. I wonder if people are picking the Eagles because they're hoping they win and hoping that they knock off Tom Brady so Tom Brady in no way, shape, or form can come into Lambeau Field again and spoil the party. Or if they really believe that, hey, the run is over. You know, you lost one of your best wide receivers. Your other wide receiver was a nut. He's gone. You've been kind of banged up. Your secondary's been depleted. You know, legitimately, it's time for this team to go by the wayside. Or if they're just saying to themselves, man, I hope the Eagles win because I don't want to have Tom Brady come in here and school us all over again.
I think it's a little bit of both.
I hope the Packers face Tom. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'd love to see the Eagles win. But if the Packers face Tom Brady and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, last year, it bothered me. Last year, going into that game, I thought, boy, the Packers are a really good team. But something about Tom Brady in that season, it seemed like it was magical. This year, doesn't. It seems like Brady has almost willed them to this point. This Buccaneers team has Aaron Rodgers-type-esque performance written all over it, where Tom Brady has gone through all the adversity, has willed this team to where they're at right now. And they have no business being here, but they're here because of the quarterback. And much like Packers fans' dismay over years and years and years of saying, okay, Aaron Rodgers is 1-5 in NFC Championship games, I think at this point they're going to say, okay, they had no business being in an NFC Championship game at Lambeau Field. So for them to even get there was a monumental performance by Tom Brady. But yeah, we understand. We don't take any angst with us when it comes to losing in an NFC Championship game to the Green Bay Packers because we had no business being there to begin with. It's much like when the Packers, when they went into Seattle back in 2014, they shouldn't have been there. But by the time they got there, they were the best team and they screwed it up themselves. When they went to the NFC Championship game against the Atlanta Falcons, they had no business being there. Rodgers willed them there, even on a bad calf muscle through Dallas to get them to that point. But we knew they weren't going to win that game. Much like going into the San Francisco game when they just got ran over and dump trucked. They had no business being there, but Rodgers willed them almost to that point. The same thing I feel is very appropriate for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers this year. They've had kind of an up and down season. They haven't looked great, but they come together at the right time. And Tom Brady kind of just grabs those guys by the scruff of their neck and drags them across the finish line and wills them there. But that's what I feel this year's all about, that this is just getting there was really good. Coming back from a Super Bowl win with all the adversity, you knew it wasn't going to be the same thing. They tried to put the band back together. It's never the same. You can never recreate the exact same thing in another year. It just doesn't happen because guys change, faces change, injuries change things. So Brady's kind of grabbed him by the scruff of the neck and drug him across the finish line. So it wouldn't surprise me if they lose this game, and it wouldn't surprise me if they come into Lambeau Field playing for an NFC championship. But I still think that the Packers are the best team and that it's the Packers' time to go. I can lay my head on the pillow at night, comfortably knowing that when we all reconvene out in L.A., and we're trying to find our way and whatever the hell that highway is, or whether it's on the 10 or the 465 or whatever the hell it is. And we're all stuck in traffic but we're all Packers fans sitting out there going, yeah, it's our time. We may miss the game because of traffic, but it's our time. It's time to go. This is the year, the last dance. It's all come to fruition. Short of Rodgers going down with an injury, I don't think there's anything that's going to derail it. Knock on wood, by the way. I just kind of feel that. 877-867-1670. If you want to find us. Brett says, if San Francisco or Philly wins, do you think Green Bay would play Saturday? Yeah, it's possible. It's possible. But because they've got an NFC game on Monday, and should the Rams win, I get the feeling that they're going to have the NFC game on Sunday and the AFC games on Saturday. Just my thought. I haven't seen anything that's going to indicate differently right now, but I get the feeling that the Packers are going to play next Sunday. Joe says, Saul Bart Scott on ESPN today say that in cold weather games, the players need to take Viagra to increase circulation, and it will help you stay warm. Imagine the locker room after the game, though. Well, if the game goes more than 4 hours, we talked about it yesterday, then you don't have to worry about it. There you go. Now, the question is, okay, Joe, let me ask you this. If you're going to take Viagra to stay warm, do you take it during warmups or before you run out of the tunnel? When do you actually take it? Because you would have to figure, if it's supposed to last a certain number of hours, do you take it right before you run out of the tunnel for a 3-hour game to have that extra hour effect just in case? Or do you take it earlier just in case other things happen and you need to go recompose yourself? How are we looking? Think about it. Coming up next, Andrew Brrandt, the Business of Sports podcast, the former capologist for the Green Bay Packers, writes with the MMQB. Andrew Brrandt is going to join us coming up. Stay tuned. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show on a Friday. Don't forget, coming up a couple of hours from now, it's the Sauce. AJ Dillon going to join us live. Stick around. We got a lot more on a Friday. I'm fired up today. We'll be back.
This is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
It was a battle of ranked teams as number 16 Ohio State came to the Kohl Center to take on number 13 Wisconsin as the Badgers went away with a 78-68 victory. Johnny Davis would have a quiet night scoring only 14 points on 4 of 8 shooting, but it would be Brad Davison's 25 and Tyler Wall's 20 that led the Badgers to victory. They now sit 14-2, 5-1 in Big Ten play, and will travel to Northwestern to face the Wildcats next Tuesday. To the NFL, the good news on the injury front keeps rolling for the Green Bay Packers as Whitney Mercilus was at practice yesterday going through drills with the rest of the outside linebackers. The veteran tore his left bicep against the Seahawks in mid-November and was thought to be done for the season, but with him practicing, it means the Packers have designated him to return from the IR. On the offensive side of the ball, David Bakhtiari, Josh Myers back at practice. The offensive coordinator, Nathaniel Hackett, was asked, will there be challenges getting them ready for the playoffs?
Yes, I think the biggest one is just football condition. We can all go on our Pelotons. We can all go out and run. We can all go in the weight room. We can all try to simulate football, but there is nothing like the game of football.
Next weekend, the Packers will host the lowest seed remaining after the Super Wild Card weekend.
Keeping Wisconsin strong. All business owners want the same thing, to make their business succeed. At Rural Mutual, they help that happen. As the third largest writer of commercial business in Wisconsin, they take the time to learn your business so they can properly protect you. Call your local agent today or visit ruralmutual.com. Rural Mutual Insurance,
keeping Wisconsin strong. Giannis Antetokounmpo had his third triple-double of the season, 30 points, 12 rebounds, and 11 assists, as the Bucks would beat the Golden State Warriors 118-99 last night at the Pfizer Forum. The Deer are back in action tomorrow when they host the Raptors. For the Wisconsin Sports Zone Network, I'm Ebo.
Welcome back to the program, hour number two of the Bill Michaels Show. We got a good one coming up today. We are going to be talking with Zach Heilprin next hour about that Badger victory last night. Also, AJ Dillon, Quadzilla, going to be joining us in the last hour of the program. So is Mike Clemens, our green and gold insider, is going to be here. But now we kind of turn things over to our good buddy Andrew Brrandt, who is joining us again on the hotline. Andrew, how you been, buddy?
I'm doing well, Bill. Happy winter to you guys.
Yeah, you too. And weather looks like it may play a part in some of the games this weekend as well, as we got this big giant blob of things going to the west of us, and it's going to go down around the country and back up the East Coast. So we'll probably see some of that this weekend. But first of all, the coaching carousel in the National Football League. Interesting. Culley gets fired in Houston. Obviously, Flores was somewhat surprising down in Miami. As far as his record goes, now we know that internal things can happen behind the scenes that say, okay, maybe this guy is not going to be the guy that's going to lead us forward. But what's the most desirable right now in your eyes when it comes to a coaching position that's open?
Oh, it's hard to know these things. You know, I remember three years ago that everyone was talking about, well, the Browns deal is more desirable than the Packers. I'm just laughing. So I think what people think now is going to be different than what happens later. obviously, you look at the quarterback situation and all these situations and where is it going. And teams that fire coaches tend to have unsettled quarterback situations. That's usually what happens. Because if you don't have that position settled, it leads to poor performance, which leads to change. So you'd look at rosters, and just to give people an inside view, when we interviewed coaches, I was there through two coach changes with the Packers. It does come to general management looking at the coach and saying, how are they going to use our personnel? When we sat with Mike McCarthy or Sean Payton or whoever we interviewed, we just kind of went through the roster. And what do you like? What do you not like? How would you use these players? So it's interesting. You know, the Packers are a little different than other teams where it's not an owner and you're not whining and dining so much as really getting into the guts of the football team. That's our experience in Green Bay.
With the eyes now, because of, I think the only African-American head coach is Mike Tomlin now. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, it's an issue. We had three last week, black coaches. Now we have one, and obviously that's going to be an issue that people are looking at. With eight vacancies, is there going to be at least one black head coach hired? We're going to see if that comes out of it, general manager as well. You know, I did a deep dive on my podcast this week, the Business of Sports podcast I host every week. And I had Jim Rooney, who's the son of Dan Rooney, who authored the Rooney Rule, to sort of look on how it's working, you know, how it's been working, where it stands, and is it working, and how do you deal with situations like, for instance, Mark Davis with the Raiders 3 years ago saying, I want John Gruden, and any other interview is going to be a sham interview, white or black or Hispanic. So there's really tough ways to handle this because owners get set on a certain hire. But yeah, the world is watching the NFL right now.
So what, I guess, for lack of a better term, how do you break through that? I understand, look, you can bring guys in and maybe somebody wows you. Maybe you open your eyes and go, wow, I didn't realize this guy was this intelligent or this guy was this organized or this guy was this motivational. I mean, that's what that's there for. So that's a good thing. But in this business, which is so incestuous in the sense of everybody knows everybody, everybody's got their favorite guy. Everybody's got a guy they like, right?
Yeah, I asked these experts about the Rooney Rule. How do you deal with that? And they pointed to exactly that situation, Mark Davis, where no one in the world was going to come between him and John Gruden. And frankly, last year in Jacksonville, where no other interview was going to matter because they had their eyes set on Urban Meyer, and we know how that turned out, of course. But they said the way to combat that is after the fact, to have sanctions against the Raiders or Jaguars or whoever for nine. Because if teams see sanctions, that's going to get their attention. Now, again, is it fine? Is it low draft picks? Whatever it may be. But that's what that's the only way to get attention of these owners. But again, you know, I remember talking to Bill Polian, and he said that he found out that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers fired a guy named Tony Dungy, and he's like, that's it. My search is over. I want Dungy. And in 10 minutes, he called Dungy and said, what do you want? You're our coach. And in Indianapolis, so again, it can go, that obviously was the situation with the roles of races reversed, but this is what happens.
So now you take us through this process, because you got a guy like Nathaniel Hackett for the Green Bay Packers. He's got three different teams that are interested in him. And in the old days, like you said, it was flying him out, it was whining and dining him. But in today's day and age with Zoom, do you do it Zoom? Or, I mean, because tell me what it's like for a coach during a bye week when you're getting ready for your next opponent and you're going into the postseason and you've got an offensive coordinator flying to Denver, flying to Jacksonville, flying all over the country, and he's not there in your own backyard.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I don't know how LaFleur is scheduling things this weekend. Maybe you guys do, so maybe they have quote-unquote off days to begin with on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So it's not that big a deal because, you know, you want people to get away this weekend. It's give them a little bit of break. That's the goal of the bye week. So in that situation, you want the focus back. I think it gets tough as you go through the playoffs, where these teams are making decisions and cutting the list. Right now, everybody's got a big list. But if they cut the list I really feel for teams like the Packers, well, they'll have coaches sort of getting to the final four of these teams as the playoffs go on. That's always happened. And I don't know how you prevent that. You can't tell owners, hey, don't really conduct your full search until February. It just won't happen. It'll never fly. Now they've allowed, because of Zoom and the pandemic, you have all these interviews going on earlier and earlier. Not a huge lift to go 2 hours for a Zoom interview. But as it gets further along, that's where I worry.
I want to ask you as well, as a roster guy, the way things have gone this year, because they give the exemptions, guys can come back off of the IR as we're seeing now. I got to admit, I like the Super Wild Card weekend. I like for guys that, blood, sweat, and all that kind of stuff going through training camp, and then in the season they get injured, but all of a sudden guys are coming back and teams are getting healthier, and the guys that really wanted to strive for a ring now have an opportunity. Do you like the scenario that the NFL is playing with this year, with guys coming back off of the IR and the management of the roster and the massage of the roster and such?
Yes, I do, and I said it last year, 2020, this sort of what's the word, this flexibility with IR and practice squad, that's the other part of it. Well, you're signing guys on practice squad that are 10-year vets. I mean, we could never do that in my day.
Right.
We could only sign practice squad guys who never had an NFL game in their background. And now they're signing, they're signing Le'Veon Bell, and they're signing Adrian Peterson to practice squads. It's like, wow. And this roster flexibility that came out of COVID, and hopefully one day we're out of COVID, I think will continue. I don't see the downside, right? So if you're the NFL, what's the downside? What's the downside of letting guys come back and forth in 3 weeks and letting older players jump on the practice squad for a couple weeks? Yeah, there really isn't any in my view. So I think it's all good.
I think it's been fantastic. A lot of energy and a lot of keeping up with, because it's almost breaking news about every 10, 15 minutes with somebody else coming back, somebody being cleared to play. I mean, it's been exciting. I do got to ask, and I'm getting a lot of people over on the feed that are saying, hey, with everything Aaron has said and the way he seems content.
Here we go.
Yeah, here we go. And it's coming every interview. I mean, because I look at it this way, Andrew, and I'll tell you my scenario, and this is what I tell people, and you tell me if I'm wrong. I've always said, I think from the day I've interviewed Aaron, from the day he and I sat down when we used to do those rookie symposiums and we'd sit with the media, it was just him and I, because nobody gave a damn about him, because Brett Favre was still the man. So everybody was interviewing other players. So it was always, he wanted to be the best. He wanted to have a legacy. He wanted to win more championships than anybody in Green Bay. I still believe that that's his makeup, even though there's been a lot of things that have been said. What it comes down to is basically money and the ability to keep him with a contract. Is it up to him to say, I will take less money, or let's kick the can down the road? Or, because to me right now, the only way that he plays here next year is if they can figure it out financially, because otherwise he has got a handicap on the team and they just simply cannot afford to keep him. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Well, I think I'll address the bigger issue. I mean, listen, I'm patting myself on the back first, because I was the only one in really national media that just said, listen, he's back. 2021.
Right.
2021, Aaron is not going anywhere. He's not retiring, and the Packers aren't trading him. So all the drama created by ESPN or whoever else, fine. Just ignore it. Ignore it. Aaron's back. And he was, of course. Now, what I've also said all along is that I saw 2022 as the transfer point. The transfer point from him to Love, because we kept Aaron on the bench for 3 years. I just think we're in a different age where 2 years is about the max, where you can keep a first-round quarterback on the bench. And I know everyone's going to say, well, so what? Love sits another year. So what? Well, so what is putting off the plan? Because it's become very clear through all the comments from Murphy and Gutekunst and LaFleur, that there really has never been a plan to have Aaron pass 2021. I don't think there has been. Now, will it change? I don't know. I mean, I think there are two parts to this. One, do we just think because Aaron's serene and happy and content and having a great year and seems to get along better with Gutekunst that all the issues he had with the team are behind us? I think that's a simplistic way of looking at it. And then it's the other side. The other side is they traded up for Jordan Love. And I just don't think they intended for 3 years. I don't think they did. And then if they intended for, if 3 years is the absolute maximum to keep Love on the bench, then you're going into a lame duck year for Rodgers. Does he want that? So what you're saying, I think, is that are the Packers going to make a commitment to Aaron Rodgers, not just for 2022? And there I see a problem, because then you're basically saying, we just wasted a number one pick. And knowing Brian Gutekunst from the Ted Thompson legacy, you never want to waste the number one pick. Never.
Right.
And I know everyone's saying it in their radio right now, like, but he's Aaron Rodgers, but he's the MVP, but he's playing better than ever, but he likes the team. I know. I've been there with Brett Favre. I've been there. It's like, does this organization pivot because of this player playing better than anyone thought 2 years ago, or does it stick to its plan?
You knew behind the walls of 1265 what you had in Aaron. I mean, just from what I was told and the people that I talked to at the time, and Andrew talking to you, and it yeah. seemed like you really knew that Rodgers had this in him, or maybe not to this level of greatness, but you knew that you were comfortable in that transition, correct?
I think you just said it. Certainly, we never said, okay, here's the future MVP, here's right. the future Hall of Famer, here's the future one of the best quarterbacks ever to live. But I said it on your program and thousands of other times. There was a way about him where like, oh my God, you know, there's right. something special here. And just the way he carried himself and his obviously on-field exploits, intelligence off the charts. And what we saw in those two off seasons where Brett was staying in Mississippi and he ran the team. And I see where this question's going. Have they seen that in Love? I have no idea. But they did see it this offseason because Aaron stayed away. And they did see it in Kansas City. And they've seen things in practice. I guess my answer is they're not going to know much differently if this lasts another year, absent a horrific injury to Rodgers. So they've got to make their decision.
Right. Yeah.
And I've talked about how hard it was with Aaron and Brett, hearing from Brett, like, I don't want to sit there with my placement every day, and hearing from Aaron's side, am I ever, ever, ever going to play? And I'm sure they're managing the same things.
Andrew, it's always great to talk to you, man. I love picking your brain. Always fun. Good stuff. And obviously exactly. we'll talk more about coaching hirings and stuff. And unless something happens with Aaron, when we get you back on, I won't ask you about Aaron. I promise.
Okay. Sure we will. Yeah. I had some tweets about the newsletter, too. So I do this newsletter every week. Just sign up at andrew-brandt.com, and then I'll be offering some premium content for people who want a little more education about the business.
I just signed up, as a matter of fact, and I can't believe I hadn't signed up until just now, but I just clicked on it, and I just signed up. So and I can't wait to get the newsletters, too. So good stuff. All right, buddy. Enjoy the weekend, the Super Wild Card weekend, and we'll chat again soon, okay?
Thanks, Bill.
Thanks, pal. Appreciate it. There you go. Andrew Brandt, the Business of Sports podcast. SIMMQB. You can find him at Andrew Brandt over on Twitter. And just really good stuff. I love it when he takes us inside. And I've said this all along. There is something to all this when it comes down to Aaron Rodgers and the decision. There's something to all of this. I'll tell you what it is when we come back, and The All-Pro team is out. The same 50 voters who vote for the MVP have voted for the All-Pro quarterback. We'll tell you the lineup when we come back. Stay tuned. There's more of the Bill Michael Show right after this.
Ready? This is the Bill Michael Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Gina Della from Pella, Windows and Doors of Wisconsin, with today's top 10 reasons to see PellaWI.com now. Number 10.
My Pella team installs year-round.
Number 9.
Every installer certified for your action.
Number 8.
My Pella team completes installations in as little as one day.
Number 7 through 5.
A 2020 survey rated Pella Windows number 1 for highest value, highest quality, and most preferred by Green Bay and Milwaukee homeowners.
Numbers 4 and 3.
Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin has 6 lines to fit your style and financing to fit any budget.
Number 2.
Now Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin's featured offer gives you 5 years no interest plus 5 months no payments.
And the number 1 reason to see PellaWI.com now.
These offers end January 31st.
Set your free consultation today at PellaWI.com.
Some restrictions apply. See show for details.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
What did you learn? Anything? Good stuff. Good stuff from Andrew Brrandt. join us on the hotline. Getting it, and hopefully that answered a lot of your questions. Because there's a lot of discussion as to whether or not Aaron Rodgers will or will not be back. And I get it. I don't have all the answers in that particular case when it comes to whether or not he will or will not be back. But I do know that there is one thing that you can take away from all of this. The Packers know, mainly behind closed doors, what they have in Jordan Love. If they feel Jordan has this unbelievable level of talent, the move will be made to let Rodgers go. If they have that belief. Now, if Brian Gutekunst just, because Andrew said something very poignant. He said, it's not like Brian Gutekunst coming out of the Ted Thompson tree to say they wasted a first round draft choice, right? That's what he said. Andrew worked a long time with Ted Thompson, worked a long time with Ron Wolf, went through a lot of contracts, knows what goes on behind closed doors. If Brian Gutekunst and Matt LaFleur put their heads together and they're looking at each other and they're honestly having this epiphic moment, and they look at each other and say, look, he just doesn't have it. Like many first round draft choices that get opportunities, you cannot hang on to a pick because he has a number attached to him and let the team fail because of. Now, I'm not saying he does or doesn't, that he's good or not. They know behind closed doors. If they feel that Jordan Love has all of this legitimate ability, then it's a no-brainer. Then you make the move. And then you start to grow back up with Jordan Love. But if they feel, and this is it's kind of like being a jury. If you have reasonable doubt, you don't make that move. You don't. You do what you can to salvage that pick. And by that, I mean probably trading him away. You salvage that pick by trading him away, getting something for him in return, and move on and figure it out later down the road. Have a plan later down the road. Whether that's a backup in Kurt Benkert or whomever or another veteran that comes in and backs up Aaron Rodgers just in case, whatever, but you figure that out. But if you hang on to a pick because of the number, well, we traded up and he's a first round pick. Okay, that's great. You valued him at a first round, but not many other teams did. So look at your evaluation process. Look at what you did. You went against your own rule. When you said, well, you can't fall in love with a player, you did. You fell in love with a player. You knew the controversy was going to be created. You fell in love with the player. So that's when you say, either we fell in love with a guy and we shouldn't have, or he does have it. If he does have it, then that's great. Then you made the right choice. But if you even think for a minute that this is not the guy that's going to lead you into success in the future, you move on. You admit you're failing and move on. Get what you can. Salvage it. You get more respect for admitting you're wrong than holding steadfast to something that you believe in when everybody else knows you're wrong and can see through you. And that's where Gutekunst would have to make a decision. And that decision is going to come this offseason. But I tell you what, that was good stuff. And he's right when it comes to all the different coaching jobs that are out there. You know, what you're looking for is numerous things. You're looking for obviously a good quarterback in a quarterback-driven league. You're looking for money. You're looking for stability in the ownership group. You know, so it's not just about what storied franchise you may want to end up with. It's about the ownership group, the money, the inner working relationships. It's everything behind closed doors that you're going to need to do to be successful in the organization. Unless, you know, Pittsburgh or Dallas or Green Bay New England comes available. I don't think there's, I mean, the Bears have been so far removed from 1985, it's not funny. You know, I mean, the Papa Bear, George Halas, that's great in lore. You know, that's fine. Okay, there's a tremendous history there. Chicago's a big city, big market. But the success of the franchise has been few and far between. So when we say a storied franchise, yeah, you're a cornerstone of the NFL. Absolutely. But you're not this overwhelmingly successful franchise. You know, you're just now making strides to own your own stadium, to have your own say, to get out from underneath the thumb of the parks department. What they did to Soldier Field was a travesty. It's like everything that the organization has done has been to demean it and not build upon its history and not build upon its success. And therefore, they haven't had the success. They've tried, but they just haven't had the success. You got to turn it around. And if somebody wants to take on that job, somebody will, and say that it's the storied franchise, well, that's fine. But it doesn't mean a hill of beans in today's day and age. Because Jacksonville's got money. They got a quarterback. They've also got the ability to go out and get additional free agents. And you're probably going to have the free hand of the ownership group. See what you can do in Jacksonville. Minnesota's got a lot of opportunity. Denver is a quarterback away from being really a really solid team in the AFC. So there's franchises that are far and away ahead of you at this point. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. Jeff said, best two interviews I've heard on your show, Andrew today and Nathaniel yesterday. Well, thank you. Appreciate it. Good stuff. Let's do this. When we come back, I'll tell you what the All-Pro team is. The 50 voters who vote for the All-Pros are the same voters who are going to be voting for the MVP. And I'll tell you how the votes came down. You'll be a little surprised. Tune in. We got more of the Bill Michaels Show next.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Michaels will resume in 4 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. We'll be right back. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Michael's will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Glad to have you back. The Bill Michaels Show continues on this Friday. This portion of the program brought to you by our good friends over there at Pella Windows and Doors in Wisconsin. Don't forget it, Pella. They got top 10 reasons. Top 10, 10, mind you, why you should be going with Pella. Pella Windows and Doors in Wisconsin, fantastic. Number 10, they do it year-round. They install year-round. You don't have to wait for spring or anything like that. Number 9, every Pella of Wisconsin installer, they are certified. Complete satisfaction is what you're going to get. Yeah. Number 8, Pella of Wisconsin. They complete installations in as little as a day. And they do it a room at a time. So your whole house isn't going to be freezing cold in the wintertime. Now, 7 through 5, think about it this way. The national survey, Pella number 1 for highest value, highest quality, most preferred by homeowners. There you have it. Number 4, number 3, that's because they have 6 lines that can fit, 6 lines, hardware, all that kind of stuff that can fit your style, your budget. That's the best part. And then the financing. The financing right now, 5 years, no interest, 5 months, no first payment. Right now, by the end of the month, got to get it done by the end of the month. Simple. The offer ends January 31st. So those are all the top 10 reasons why you should get a hold of our friends at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. Set up your free consultation today. Go to PellaWI.com, P-E-L-L-A, PellaWI.com, or call them 855-PellaWI. That is 855-PellaWI. Now, the 2021 All-Pro roster is out. The Associated Press, selected by a national panel of 50 media members. These are the same people, by the way, that vote for the MVP. Okay. Aaron Rodgers received 34 of the All-Pro votes. Tom Brady got the other 16. Think about that for a minute. 34, 16 people chose Tom Brady over Aaron Rodgers, but all of them were split between the two. Rodgers wins out being the All-Pro quarterback. He gets the nod at quarterback. Running back, Jonathan Taylor out of Indianapolis. That's a no-brainer. Tight end, Mark Andrews from Baltimore. The wide receiver, a unanimous decision, was Devontae Adams. Cooper Kupp from the Rams, Debo Samuel out of San Francisco. The left tackle, Trent Williams from San Fran. The right tackle, Tristan Wirfs from Tampa Bay. The left guard, Joel Bitonio from Cleveland. Zach Martin from Dallas at the right guard. Jason Kelce from Philadelphia. There you go. That's your offense all pro. Your defense, the edge rusher is TJ Watt, which that's a no-brainer from Pittsburgh. Miles Garrett from Cleveland. Those two guys are animals. The interior lineman, Aaron Darnold from the Rams. Cam Hayward from Pittsburgh. The linebacker, Darius Leonard from Indianapolis. Micah Parsons from Dallas. Devondre Campbell. When was the last time a defender made the all-pro team for the Packers? Devondre Campbell. Cornerbacks, Trayvon Diggs from Dallas, Jalen Ramsey from the Rams. Safeties, Kevin Byard from Tennessee, Jordan Poyer from Buffalo. The special teams, the place kicker was Justin Tucker from Baltimore. Punter, A.J. Cole from Vegas. Kick returner, Braxton Berrios from the Jets. Punt returner, Devin Duvernay from Baltimore. And it goes on from there. But you get Davante Adams, all pro, unanimous. Devondre Campbell having a hell of a season. All pro, and then Aaron Rodgers. Why is that important? Well, it's important because, like we said, 50 of the voters, 34 voted for Rodgers, 16 voted for Brady. The same guys that are going to be picking the MVP. It is always indicative as to who will win the MVP when you have those votes, those all pro teams come out. So if it holds true, that means Aaron Rodgers will win the MVP. He had 39 more votes to break a tie, so to speak. 25 and 25 would be a tie. He had 9 votes more. Or excuse me. Yeah, nine votes more. He had 34. So it's a big deal because of that. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. ESPN Steve says Ted Thompson would never admit that he made a mistake in the draft. He would let a high draft pick play through his contract, not re-sign him. I hope Brian Gutekunst does not follow in that trait and cuts a player loose or trades him if he does not live up to expectations. Ted, who did Ted choose? Well, there was Justin Harrell, who they let him go by the wayside. But Ted had a couple of draft choices that I gave him credit for that he, after three seasons, he kind of went, nah. And they just kind of cut bait with him. But I will agree with you. There was times where, because he was a high draft choice, and Ted was really good at where Gutekunst has been great. And Ted was always good at saying, well, he's an athlete. Dayton Jones, Nick Perry, those guys, he's an athlete. We're going to put a square peg in a round hole. They had no business being edge rushers and such, or trying to make them down linemen when they were really an outside stand-up guy, you know, because they're athletic. It was always trying to fit a square peg into a round hole. Gutekunst is finding guys that play that position. Maybe you could say Rashad Gary is a little bit of the hybrid because he's the way they drafted him versus the way he's played. And the way he played in college is a little different, but he's been effective. You could see the vision. But the one thing that they use interchangeably is offensive linemen. They'll draft tackles that may be a little undersized, but they can play guard as well. They can be versatile. They can play left. They can play right. But they're gonna make sure that offensive line is always fortified. Always fortified. Maybe went a little bit undersized with Tyler Lancaster. Dean Lowry might not have, this year he's living up to the contract, but might not have really deserved all of that, but kind of the best option at the time, but he's kind of living up to that. But Rashawn Gary, I give him credit because Rashawn Gary, when they drafted him, I thought, oh boy, this is, you know, for what they're getting, they're trying to get this edge rusher, this guy that had one big highlight play. And I'm like, man, I don't know if that's going to be it, you know? And boy, he's really convinced me that he's become a bull force. Now he doesn't have a great move. He doesn't have that undercut hammer like Reggie did, or he's not Julius Peppers with quick feet and quick hands, and he could just out muscle you when he needed to. He's not that guy. He's just a guy that's going to bull rush you and stick your ass in the back of the quarterback. The butt is coming at the quarterback, and he can do it. And there's something for that. Good leverage, down low. He's been really good. Phil says, I hope Rodgers does win the MVP. That would mean history is against the Packers winning the Super Bowl. You have to go back to 1999 when Kurt Warner won the MVP and the Super Bowl, and only nine in the history. There's been a total of 10 players in history that have won the MVP and gone on to win a Super Bowl. So go worry about the who wins the MVP, and the rest of the teams will go get the ring. That's from Phil. Phil, what if, now think about this, Phil, for the first time in history, this is a kind of a blazing of the path, that Rodgers wins the MVP, LaFleur wins Coach of the Year, and they win a Super Bowl, something that's never been done. Think of that. Maybe they're blazing a path. History would tell you that that's pretty much out of the realm of possibility, but they would be the first team to do it. Maybe that's the kind of season it is, in a dominating fashion. 877-867-1670. Hey, speaking of mojo, good point, Ben. We completely forgot about the Manning cast curse, didn't we?
I was thinking about it when they lost to Detroit.
Rodgers gets the start. They come out. They lose against Detroit. The Manning cast curse is now gone.
Put aside whether the game actually helped Rodgers get Devontae the record and helped Rodgers keep his mojo going for the playoffs. Now there's no curse when he goes and plays in the divisional round.
Think about that. There you go. That's true. And Rodgers started the game. They take credit for the loss, but when he was playing pretty well when he ended up coming out of the game, it was the defense that gave up flea flickers that ultimately cost him the game. And then obviously the inability to continually move the ball down the field by Jordan Love and the stupid throwing it up to anybody to catch it interception late in the ball game. But yeah, they got that out of the way. Maybe they are just destined at this point. Think about that. Good stuff. Stay tuned. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show. Next!
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. We'll be right back. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Now, in Green Bay, here's Mike Clemens.
The Packers held another outdoor practice during the bye week. Seven players have returned from injury, including veteran right tackle Billy Turner, linebacker Za'Darius Smith, and even outside linebacker Whitney Mercilus, who back in November was told his torn bicep was season-ending. Packers defensive coordinator Joe Barry.
He's been saying since, you know, the night that he got hurt, he's like, I'm going to be back. I'm coming back. I promise you I'm coming back. He's worked his tail off to get to where he's at. And yes, I was completely surprised that it was, you know, as early as today, but it was great to have him out there.
So the players will have the weekend off, but Packers offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett has three job interviews with the Jaguars, Broncos, and Chicago Bears about their head coaching openings.
When you're talking to people, it's not as much X's and O's as people would think. It's more just about kind of the person that you are, how you would lead the team, how you would handle the team. And it's been a great experience here because how we do it here is how I want to do it. And so it's kind of been a on-the-job training since I got here with Matt.
And I asked safety Adrian Amos if he's ever woke up on a Sunday morning during a bye week, restless to play in a game.
When I wake up, you know, because, you know, usually before a game, I wake up in a hotel. So I know how I'm waking up with my son screaming. So I know it's not game day. So I think this bye, you know, is good for our bodies. It's good for us learning the fundamentals, getting back to fundamentals. We can do extra stuff that you don't really get to do.
In Green Bay, I'm Mike Clemens on the Bill Michaels Show.
Welcome back. Bill Michaels Show, we continue on. Glad to have you today. And coming up after the top of the hour, we're going to talk about that Badger game last night. Zach Heilprin going to be joining us. And we'll talk with Zach about the Badgers' win over Ohio State and then getting more into this team as the season moves forward. Good stuff last night. And then coming up in the last hour of the show, A.J. Dillon, running back for the Green Bay Packers. He's going to be here. He'll join us. We'll talk with him about it. If you got a question for A.J., get it in. We'll see what we can ask. We'll try to get a couple of questions from the gallery, if you will. We'll try to get a couple of those in for you. And also Mike Clemens. He's going to be our closer again today. We'll talk with him about the Packers and the bye week and then obviously getting ready for Super Wild Card weekend, what to look for. And then it all gets real. Starting next week in so many different ways. So we got all that coming up here in just a little bit. Mark says, does this mean that Aaron Rodgers will win the MVP because he was voted to the All-Pro team? I'm not saying he will, but I'm saying the likelihood of it because of now there is division in the voters, which we thought, you know, look, Brady's had a hell of a season. There's no denying that. Brady is a highly rated quarterback. For a long time, he was considered to be the MVP. And then Rodgers just gradually just kept playing well and better and better and better and better. And then all of a sudden, it became Aaron Rodgers' team and Aaron Rodgers' award to lose. I think certainly, as Hub Arkish put it, there are some people that feel the way he feels, that Rodgers is a bad guy, Rodgers misled his team or misled the league or whatever. I mean, I don't think he did, but there are some people that took offense to what he had to say, and Rodgers knew it. But Rodgers' play this year, for him to be voted as the All-Pro, 36 votes to 16 votes for Brady, for him to be voted in that light says a lot about how well he's played this year. You know, it says a lot about how well he's played this year. Just think about that. In the grand scheme of things, all right, in the grand scheme of things, it says a lot to how well Aaron Rodgers has played this season for voters to be saying, you know what, I got to give it to the guy. Because there's probably voters out there going, no, I don't want to give it to the guy. But you kind of have to because of how well he's played. Because of what he's done. So that's the reason you kind of look at this and you go, yeah, you know, he very, very likely will end up being the MVP because he's exceeded. He's played so well. People had to put their bias aside to say, I hate it. Maybe it's I'm doing what I despise, but you got to give it to the guy because he's played extremely well. So that's the reason I think that Rodgers will indeed get it. That's the reason I think he's going to get the MVP. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to chime in, go ahead and hit us up. Again, 877-867-1670. Some people chiming in over on the Bud Light live stream. Rodgers, simply the best. You got to give it to him. That's coming from Brett. ESPN Steve says, please ask AJ what his favorite place in Door County is. We're going there this weekend. Oh, well, there you go. Paul says, what are the predictions for the weekend? My predictions for the weekend, let's do this real quick. Okay, we went through this last night. Until Cincinnati wins a postseason game, I'm going with the Raiders. I just, as much as I like Joe Burrow and I think he's changed the attitude of that team, I'm going with the Raiders. The Bills at home, I just don't think they lose. They were my pick at the beginning of the season. When they lost to New England in that wind game in Buffalo, I thought, oh boy, okay, maybe. When you saw Buffalo and Josh Allen take a few losses inexplicably, I'm like, wow, what the hell? But I think they're back, and I think they've got a legitimate shot. So I'm taking Buffalo. As much as I want to see Philadelphia get a win, I think Tampa Bay does get the win. Just because they're getting some of their guys back. Now, we'll wait and see what their defensive front does against this run game. But if there's an upset to be had, I think that might be one of them. The other one, if you want to call it an upset, would be San Francisco beating Dallas. I'm taking San Francisco. I'm taking Tampa Bay to get the win, but I'm taking San Francisco to win in Dallas. I kind of goes against what I believe, but Mike McCarthy is just really good at getting his guys ready, motivated, what have you, for postseason games. And I know that. We've seen Mike trip up, but more so the defensive front of the San Francisco 49ers and some of the things that Bosa had to say, I think they're just kind of coming in, letting it all hang out, and they're going after him. And if Dak Prescott is not on point, and they get him to turn the ball over a couple of times, and he's not Dak Prescott that we saw a couple of weeks ago against Washington, but more so Dak Prescott here at the end of the season, Dallas is going to win that game. So I'm taking San Francisco. As much as I would love to see, excuse me, Big Ben and a rematch of the Super Bowl with the Packers and the Steelers, there's no way. I think Kansas City gets the win almost going away in that contest. And then the Monday night game, the Rams and the Cardinals, coming in as the number 5 seed, the Rams, the number 4 seed. I think the Rams, with everything they have going, I think this is Cliff Kingsbury and Kyler Murray's, you know, this is when they have some expectations going to the postseason. They're their first toe dip into the postseason. You got to grow. You got to walk before you can run. And I just don't think that Arizona's ready yet. And I do think that McVay and company, they've been there, they've done that. They know what it takes. They picked up Von Miller. They picked up OBJ. And they made the trade for Stafford. The only thing that changes the tide in that game is if Stafford starts playing Detroit Lions Matthew Stafford football. Otherwise, I think the Rams win. So, again, I'm going to go with the Raiders on the road, Buffalo at home, Tampa Bay at home, San Francisco on the road. Then I'm going to take Kansas City at home. And the Rams at home. That's my picks for the weekend. So there you go. Hopefully that satisfies you. And we'll see how it comes out. Good stuff. Hey, coming up next, we're going to talk about that win last night. Got to. Badgers get a big win over Ohio State. We'll talk with Zach Heilprin, sports director from The Zone out in Madison. As we're at the halfway point of the program. 2 hours down, 2 hours yet to go, so hang in there. A lot more of the Bill Michaels Show. It's coming up, and it's coming up next. We'll be right back.
This is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
Well, Wisconsin's won six straight games for a second time this year. That's after the Badgers took down number 16 Ohio State last night, 78-68. They got it done behind 25 points from Brad Davison and 20 points, 7 rebounds, and 6 assists from Tyler Wall. Johnny Davis had an off night offensively, scoring 14 points. Badgers hit 10 three-pointers, tied for their most in the game this year. Six different guys hit at least one. The win avenged Ohio State beating Wisconsin last month. Badgers' only Big Ten loss this year. UW improved to 14-2 on the season. Best start ever under Greg Gard, and 5-1 Big Ten play has them sitting in third place, a half game back of leaders Illinois and Michigan State. Wisconsin will visit Northwestern next Tuesday. Turn to the Bucks. They ran Golden State off the floor last night. They won 118-99 win that wasn't as close as the score sounded. Milwaukee led by 39 points at the half, the second largest halftime lead in franchise history. Giannis Antetokounmpo put together a triple-double, scoring 30 points, grabbing 12 rebounds, dishing out 11 assists. Chris Middleton had 23 points. Bobby Portis gave them 20. The win snapped a two-game losing streak. They're going to be back in action tomorrow night when Toronto comes to town.
Rural Mutual Insurance, the number one farm insurer in Wisconsin, is here for you even when the weather isn't. With crop hail damage, protect your operation from hail, fire, lightning, and more. Visit ruralmutual.com/farm.
Rural Mutual Insurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
Well, the Packers back in the field for one more day of practice this week before getting the weekend off. Meanwhile, assistant coaches interviewing for head coaching positions. Quarterbacks coach Luke Getsy going to interview with the Broncos today, while offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett will do so with the Jaguars. He has two other interviews as well. With this Wisconsin Sports Zone Network update, I'm Zach Heilprin.
Welcome back to the Bill Michaels Show. We continue on, and we're glad you're with us today. The voice you just heard was that of one Zach Heilprin, sports director of the Zone, WOZN in Madison. And we now get him on the line as he joins us, and we talk a little bit more about that fantastic game last night. Zach, how you doing, pal?
Doing good, Bill.
So just give me your thoughts as to what the Badgers did last night. It was just nothing short of amazing the way they just kind of dominated Ohio State.
It was, and I think the biggest thing about it is obviously Tyler Wall was great and Brad Davison was great, 25 points. It's that they did it without a great performance from Johnny Davis offensively. Like, he has been fantastic offensively for most of the year. He's the reason they are where they are for the most part. For him to go 4 of 18, scored 14 points, but, you know, to go 4 of 18 and for them to somehow still win, and really the 10-point margin wasn't probably indicative of how much they dominated that game. It was 17. You know, they just didn't finish well. We've seen that a couple times. But for them to do what they did without Johnny Davis having a great game has to be just so good for their confidence that they don't need to count on him if he's having an off night. Other guys are going to be able to step up, and we saw that last night. That was my biggest takeaway from that.
So moving forward now, we talk about expectations all the time and what the expectations should be for the Badgers. I like what Ben had to say last night, that this team just has this unchallengeable grit to them. And I see that. And I talked about that. I talked about just kind of the way that the hustle plays, the way they play basketball. This team, it looks like a team like I don't want to say they're peaking now, because certainly they can get better. But there's not a lot of flaws in their game when they're doing the hustle things that they've done in the past. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think, you know, that certainly this team has, you know, some things that they don't do great. Now, last night they shot it well from three, right? They had hit 10 three-pointers, but that has been a major, major issue for them. But you talk about the grit and the fight, and I think it's their best trait. I do. I do the game after the game, like it's like a rundown of things like, you know, the good from the game. And almost always the lead is is their grit and their fight, because whether it's giving up a big lead and holding on, or coming back from a big deficit, or going down the road and beating Purdue, it's just the fight that they've played with, and they leave it all out there. And I know that's such a cliche, but they do. It is a team that you just can't count out one way or the other. They are always seems to always have an answer their team is doing, and we've seen it to the point where now they're 14-2 and they're 5-1 in Big Ten play, which is just insane. And I think their grit, as well as they do a lot of other things, I think that grit is their best attribute.
So right now, when we look, and again, we go back to the Big Ten, we look at the overall standings and the way they've kind of avenged that loss. And I got to be honest, I don't think there's a team now, after seeing what they did to Ohio State, what they did not only on the inside, but on the outside, I don't see a team right now, and beating Purdue, I don't see a team right now that really has a dominant area over the Badgers. Do you?
That's a good question. And it's one that is a difficult one to answer, because I do think Michigan State and Illinois are still the two best teams, especially Illinois. When you look at what Illinois can do down low with Kofi Coburn, and I still think Wisconsin can be, to an extent, exploited in the paint. We saw Ohio State score a ton of their points last night in the paint, but I still think Stephen Crowell and certainly Tyler Wahl have improved. And what they've given to Wisconsin, especially Tyler Wahl, since being called out by Johnny Davis after the first Ohio State game, I guess challenged would probably be a better word or a better term to use than called out, but challenged by Johnny Davis to step up and to play tougher. They certainly have in recent games. But yeah, I think next Friday night, when Michigan State comes to the Kohl Center, is going to be a huge, huge litmus test on exactly where Wisconsin is. I think they've answered every challenge to this point in the year. Obviously, Ohio State beats them by double digits last month. They come back this month, and Wisconsin beats them by double digits. So you have that avenge. Their only loss, that's the only loss with Johnny Davis on the court. So there is a lot to like about Wisconsin, obviously, Bill. You know, you want to see them play. They played some of the better teams in the conference. I'm interested to see what they look like against Michigan State and Illinois, and we'll get that next Friday night.
The one thing I noticed, I mean, Greg Gard, don't get me wrong, he's coaching, okay? But it's almost like he knows the groove they're in, because you don't see him screaming and pointing and you know what I mean? It's almost like it's okay, yeah. Guys, go do your thing. It's not, and I don't mean to make it sound like he doesn't have to coach, because these guys can play themselves, but I think it's kind of like he doesn't have to whip the horse. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And which is really works well for his personality, because that's never been him, you know, like that was Bo, and not yelling, do this and do that, but getting after guys and getting after the refs. And that was, we saw that show for 14 years on the sideline, and it was very entertaining. And Greg Gard is not that type of guy, but he doesn't need to be with this group. If you turn up the volume, especially at the Kohl Center at times when it's not very loud, which it hasn't been at times this year for whatever reason, the loudest guy on the court is Brad Davis. You can hear him yelling whether he's on the bench or whether he's on the court. Like, he has taken on a role as a coach, and obviously playing as well as he is. But like, if you listen closely, you hear Brad's voice no matter what. And so, yeah, Greg Gard doesn't have to say a lot with this group. He talks about it in the huddle sometimes. He tries to keep it even keeled, because that's his personality. And I think it works for this group for sure.
When you I don't want to get way too, you know, too far ahead of myself, but when you start to look at the standings and the way this team continues to win, where do they go next week, do you think?
You mean in terms of the rankings or the
– Yeah, in terms of the rankings. Or, I mean, this is a pretty good-sized win that they just took on by avenging a loss to Ohio State. So, obviously, you got Northwestern, but you got the big one with Michigan State coming up next Friday. But where do they go into that? Are they sitting at, say, number 11, right behind Michigan State, going into that game next Friday night?
I certainly think there's a possibility, because teams – it has not been a very good few days for – some of the top teams in the country. UCLA has lost. USC has lost. Baylor has lost. Like some of these teams that are, and I don't think they're going to jump any of those teams, but there have been some pretty big wins by teams in the top five here in the last few days that I don't think that there is. Baylor was the last undefeated team. They're not undefeated anymore. I don't think that there's a runaway team that you could sit there and say is the best team in the country. Baylor had played like it to a point, but I don't think that they are so overwhelming than anybody else. But yeah, for Wisconsin, could they move into the, I think they could move into the top 10. I think that's a possibility because they don't play again this week. And by the time the rankings come out next Monday, they'll have won six straight, sitting at 5-1 in Big Ten play, 14-2 overall. And yeah, I think that's certainly a possibility. Them, you know, potentially, seeing how this weekend goes, we'll see, potentially moving into 11, 10, 9, something around there. I think that's certainly worthwhile possibility.
Yeah, the big thing last night is not so much, and you had mentioned in your update that, you know, Davis, 14 points. It was a relatively minuscule night. Davison, obviously, with 25. But it's kind of like other guys got into the mix, and it wasn't that the bench played big minutes, but Vogt obviously coming in and getting a couple of assists, getting 4 points, a couple of buckets when it mattered, when you wanted to extend that lead or you wanted to get, because they got it within, I think, 5 or 6 at one point. You thought, uh-oh, here comes that run out of Ohio State coming out of the second half. And then it was just a couple of buckets, a couple of hard-fought plays, and then boom, off they go again. It seems like even though you're not getting 25 points off of your bench, you're getting some boards, but more so you're getting assists, you're getting a steal here and there, you're getting something. You know what I mean? It seems to be timely things that are happening at a good moment in the game.
Well, I thought they got some really quality minutes out of Lauren Bowman yesterday. Chuck Hepburn has struggled a bit. You know, we haven't seen a ton of struggles from him as a true freshman. I thought Lauren came in and gave him some nice minutes off the bench in playing that point role. And he hit a 3-pointer. We saw Jacoby Nuth, who is dealing with a leg injury. It's just, I mean, he's been beset by injuries and COVID and illness. It's been a rough year for him coming over from, coming as a transfer from Wake Forest. And, you know, the fact that he gave them a 3-pointer last night as well. Vogt has been huge at different points this year, certainly giving them a 7-footer that teams at least have to acknowledge, and they can't just roll right through them down low. So yeah, those three guys, I think, certainly have given them something off the bench. You mentioned Ohio State getting within six. It was 61-55, and then Wisconsin went on a 13-2 run itself, highlighted by plays from Brad Davison and from Tyler Wall. We got the Tyler Wall strip and steal, and then the dunk and one. You had a Brad Davison and one in there. I mean, when they got close, and this kind of goes back to the grit, they got close, Wisconsin found a different gear and took control back of the game. And that is exactly what you wanted to see in that situation, not let it get down to a one-possession game like it had against Maryland, where they even gave up the lead. This situation, not even let them get within a point or within a possession and pushing that lead back out to 7, I think it got back up to.
Well, as much as we talk about Davison and Davis, Crow last night with the and one, as you mentioned, and then the dunk, and then that screaming energy, so to speak, as the crowd just went freaking bananas. I thought his energy level was off the charts last night. And to me, when you talk about every now and then, you look at a game and you say, okay, who's that guy that's pumping you up? Now, there's a big three and such that guys will hit, but there's a guy that kind of gives you that moment. Crow was it last night.
Yeah. Yeah. Tyler Wall, like, has been fantastic these last four games, right? He had, since being challenged by Johnny Davis after the Ohio State game, where he had 3 points and was a non-factor as Ohio State just dominated down low, he has come back in his last four games, averaging 15 points a game, shooting 75% from the field, 6.3 rebounds, 2.8 assists per game. You mentioned Crowell as well. He has shot it quite well, especially down low. Like, he hasn't had like huge scoring games, but he's been efficient in the scoring that he did. He hit a three to start out the game last night, hit a three, a big three against Maryland last week. Like, they, both of those guys have made strides since Johnny Davis challenged him after the Ohio State game last month. They have been, both of them have been huge to the success that they've been able to have in this 6-game winning streak since that Ohio State game. And Tyler Wall is just at a different level in terms of his scoring right now. This is the third guy that they needed, And Tyler has certainly become that third scorer that they needed, and go along with Johnny and Brad.
Yep, no doubt. Good stuff as always. It's an exciting time for Badger basketball, and I'm going back to my hope. I hope they end up top four of the Big Ten. That would be a hell of an achievement, a hell of an accomplishment, and that'd be huge for this sort of program.
You're not going for a Big Ten championship?
Wow. I mean, if that happens to come along for the ride, yeah. But I'll be considering. I thought at the beginning of the season, I thought, you know, 7-6 somewhere in there. That'd be a pretty good accomplishment for what many consider to be one of these years in which you had maybe an eyebrow raise. And they're making believers out of everybody at this point. I was listening to the Big Ten Network last night, and I was listening to ESPN this morning, and they're making believers out of everybody.
Yeah. I mean, being coming in as the number 10 team, like that's what they were picked to finish 10th. And now to be sitting a half game out of first and being a 13th ranked team, bracketology has them sitting as a potential 3 seed and playing in Milwaukee at Pfizer Forum for those first two games or the first two rounds of the tournament. It's much bigger than anybody I think we're thinking in. So, yeah, we'll see how it plays out. Interesting to see how the rest of this thing rolls.
No doubt. Good stuff, buddy. We'll talk to you soon. Enjoy the weekend, okay?
All right, sounds good, Bill. Thank you.
There you go. That is our buddy Zach Heilprin joining us on the hotline, talking some Badger basketball. Badger hoops, man. It's that's for real. And here's the thing I was talking about this the other day with sports in Wisconsin at this point in time, usually at this point in time, we're talking, it's all Packers all the time, postseason, here we go. Okay. But what you saw, you got a couple of big games. What you saw last night out of the Badgers getting the revenge on Ohio State after going over to the Value City Arena and just looking like they just got a little manhandled there and just were out of their game. They just didn't look like this team that we'd seen all season long. To see them come back and get that big win last night, now they've crept up. They're going to be closing in on the top 10 and a huge game with Michigan State coming into the Kohl Center next Friday night. That town is – Ben, are you going to that one by any chance?
Absolutely. Okay. All my college buddies are actually coming back into town for the game.
Okay. So Ebo's not going to bump you out of it or anything like that. You don't have to like cover some kind of cooking show on another station out there in Madison, right?
No, sir. Okay. Though he might, depending on what the Eagles do this weekend, he might create something.
I could see that happening, but a big game coming up next Friday night to the Kohl Center. So, and so for everything that is right now, Packers football, provided that the Badgers don't stumble and stub their toe against Northwestern. That's a weird gym, too, to play in. Everything about Northwestern is weird. But to come back home to the Kohl Center next Friday night and take on the number 10 Michigan State Spartans. And, well, we'll see where they're at by then. Maybe Michigan State rises. I mean, there were some upsets last night as well as the Oregon Ducks got UCLA. But when you see this game next Friday night, this is going to be prior to the lead-in to the Packers for the weekend, that'll be the game. Because we saw the game out of the Bucks last night when they just destroyed Golden State and emphatically put a stamp that, hey, don't forget about us, we're the champions, oh, by the way, which was fantastic. But for college basketball, that was a big win in these parts last night. Big win. Good stuff to get Zach Heilprin on. Stay tuned. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show coming up.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back. Glad to have you on board. Hopefully, you're having a good time today on a Friday, getting ready for AJ to sauce. Dillon, Quadzilla going to be joining us coming up here in about 40 minutes, so stay tuned for that. 40 minutes away from AJ Dillon joining us. Good stuff. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. You want to find us, that's the way. Don't forget, you can find us over on Twitter, @Bill_Michaels. Find us on Facebook, go to facebook.com/TheBillMichaelsShow. You can find us on YouTube as well, and the subscriptions on YouTube continue to go up. Pretty excited about all of that. We continue to get more and more subscribers, and you can subscribe, you can follow us. It just pops up when we go on the air, and you can watch the show or listen to the show. If you want to catch us later on Spotify, iTunes, on Google Podcasts, we're out there now. We're getting bigger. We're trying to hone our skills, if you will. Trying to get it all done. So good stuff. 877-867-1670. Let's get to the phone calls, and we got a few of them, as a matter of fact. So let's go to Brett. Brett, how you doing today? What's going on, man?
Good. How's it going, Bill?
I'm feeling good today. What's you thinking?
Well, that's good. I think we all should be feeling good. We got a lot going for us here in Wisconsin.
Right now, we do.
Good stuff. So, two questions that I would ask you or get your opinion on. At this point, we've seen enough of Jordan Love. What should the Packers do at the end of the season to ensure that we have Rodgers? And second question.
Yes.
And I asked Dave Carney about this. He said he doesn't have the power, so I figured I'd ask the man. That's you. We need to get some sort of signing set up here for Johnny Davis before he goes pro.
Yeah, he can capitalize on his likeness. Yeah, we can.
Right.
Yeah,
see,
we should.
See if you can get Waukesha Sports to set that up here in lacrosse for us.
I will see if we can't get something out there now that guys can capitalize on their likeness.
I'll have some apple pie waiting for you if you make it happen.
Oh, man, I love that. Good stuff. Now you hit me right where I live. Appreciate it, man. Thanks for the phone call. Okay, let's check on. We'll have to throw it out there for Johnny Davis. I've got some ins. You know, let me see here. I was sharing a text the other day, and I hate to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway. Because it's pertinent to the show. Where is it at? Oh, come on. There it is. You know who we're going to get on the show, Ben? Eventually?
Who?
Hunter Waller.
Ooh.
Yeah. Hunter Waller. We've got an in there.
Let me tell you what, he's probably going to start at safety for the Badgers next season.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good player.
True freshman this year, named the newcomer of the year. State Gatorade player of the year last year as a senior at Muskego High School. Chose Wisconsin over offers from Ohio State, Michigan, Notre Dame, and such. So we got a little bit of an in there. Not going to tell you how, but we do. And maybe we could take that and parlay that into a Davis signing down that same avenue. I'm just throwing it out there. There's a lot of, like, I'm a duck right now. If you're watching on the Bud Light live stream, I'm a duck. You know what a duck is, right? The duck's on the water. Cool, calm, and collected. But below the surface, bam. Not wearing pants and paddling like a mother. So, cool, calm, and collected. That's what we are right now. We'll get that taken care of. When it comes to Rodgers and Love, okay? When it comes to Rodgers and Love, this is what I stated earlier. What has to happen to keep Rodgers here? Basically is this. One, you are most likely, if you throw your support into the Aaron Rodgers tank, okay? It's because you have seen Jordan Love now for a year and a half and beyond behind the scenes. You have seen him work. Brian Gutekunst knows. Okay, he knows. He either has it or he doesn't. Does he have that something? You know it when you talk to a guy. When I sat down, and I'll give you a little bit of the background. For years, when I worked in Cincinnati, I sat down with some of these guys that they were bringing in, and it was just, no. You wanted to believe, because I was young and naive, you wanted to believe that this guy was really that. And you're like, wow, okay. You know, I mean, the Kajana Carters, the David Klinglers, the Achille Smiths, all these guys would come in. And you're like, wow, okay. You get to meet these guys. And then when I come to Green Bay, then I'm sitting down and talking to Favre. And there's this presence. You know, there's sitting in on these meetings with the network stuff. It just, there's this presence. And there's this thought. And there's this something intangible. And you know it when you see it. You know it when you hear it. And then when Rodgers was drafted, and I'll never forget this. I'm sitting at this table, having this lunch, talking to Rodgers, getting to know him. And I've got kind of like my chin, my elbows on the table. My hand is under my chin. I'm just sitting there, you know, just kind of listening to him. And I'm not like some goofy schoolgirl looking at some guy going, oh my God, I'm listening like, holy crap. And I said to him, if your talent is half as good as your knowledge, you will be a Hall of Famer. Because he was just, he blew you away with the presence and the diction and the ability to speak and break things down simply for everybody to understand. And I would, for a majority of the time, I was the only guy at the table. Because, like I said, everybody, he was a backup. Nobody cared about him. Brett Favre was the quarterback. Everybody's down the road talking to other guys, you know? Nobody cared. So when you're sitting there talking to Aaron Rodgers, you're like, wow, this guy's got it. This guy's got it. He's got that intangible, you know? I mean, remember, Nick Collins was the guy that came in. He was the defensive back, the safety, him. Brady Papenga, linebacker. Junius Costin was going to be one of the offensive linemen, you know? Will Whitaker was your seventh-round draft choice, and he was going to bolster that draft and make that thing work. But it was Terrence Murphy was the wideout. That's, you know, another weapon for Brett Favre. That's who everybody was talking to. I'm sitting there talking to this Aaron Rodgers guy, and I'm like, wow. This guy's just, he's got it. So my point being is, behind closed doors, these guys are all talking every day to Jordan Love. These guys are in meetings every day with Jordan Love. These guys see him on the field every day. Is he zipping it? Is he doing the no-look pass? Is he got the swagoo, if you will? The swagger to do the belt when he runs scout team? Because that's where Rodgers got it. Rodgers was kicking the hell out of the first overall defense, running scout team, and kicking their ass. And his guys on scout team were going, do the belt. You the kid, man, do the belt. That's where the belt came from, in case you didn't know. You make your bones running scout team. How good are you? How many eyes do you open? Is he burning Jair Alexander with a no-look pass? Is he burning Devondre Campbell when that defense is coming after him and he's running scout team? Is that all happening or not? That's where you make your bones, man. Rodgers was making his bones. And then Rodgers had a couple of opportunities, and he wowed people. That game in Dallas, they didn't win the game, but Favre looked terrible. Rodgers came in, that thing ran smooth, and had they had another 5 minutes to play, they'd have won that game. I believe that. And then we all went, oh, okay, Now we've seen this guy. We know what he's all about. So my point is, behind closed doors, they know. And if Jordan Love has it, then you stick with Jordan Love. But if he doesn't, and even if you're minuscule questioning yourself going, man, did we make a mistake? Then you got to go. You got dump him. Trade him away. Get anything for him. Anything's better than nothing. And you make that deal. And then you go to Aaron and you say, Aaron, here's our problem. You're making an absolute stank-ass buttload of money. We can't afford you, but we want you here. We know you want to stay. We want you here. What do you want? And Roger's going to say, well, I want this guy. I wanted to have this. I want to talk to you. Okay, here's the problem. We owe you all this money. What do we need to do? Because we can't afford to keep all these guys. So you put on your general manager hat for a minute. This is what we need to do. And then you need to figure the money out. First, you figure out if you want Love around. Don't be just because. That's the dumbest thing you can do. And then after that, you figure it out. That's what they have to do to keep Aaron Rodgers here. Hopefully that explains it to you. 877-867-1670. Stay tuned. More of the Bill Michaels Show. We're a half hour away from the sauce. AJ Dillon joining us coming up on the Bill Michaels Show.
Ready? This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Gina Della from Pella, Windows and Doors of Wisconsin, with today's top 10 reasons to see PellaWI.com now. Number 10.
My Pella team installs year-round.
Number 9.
Every one of our installers is Pella certified to ensure your complete satisfaction.
Number 8.
My Pella team completes installations in as little as one day.
Number 7 through 5.
A 2020 survey rated Pella Windows number 1 for highest value, highest quality, and most preferred by Green Bay and Milwaukee homeowners.
Numbers 4 and 3.
Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin has 6 lines to fit your style and financing to fit any budget.
Number 2.
Now Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin's featured offer gives you 5 years no interest plus 5 months no payments.
And the number 1 reason to see PellaWI.com now.
These offers end January 31st.
Set your free consultation today at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply. See show for details.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Michaels will resume in 4 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Michael's will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back. Good to have you on this Friday, getting ready for the Super Wild Card weekend. Upsets could happen. Love it. Love it. Can't wait. What are you doing tomorrow, Ben? Are you going to be hunkered down somewhere with a big bowl of wings ready for the football season to begin to culminate?
Probably work out. I'm trying to get in shape a little bit until the first game, and then I will be on a couch probably for the next 7 hours, wake up on Sunday for the next 12.
Yeah, I'm same thing. I'm going to be at the gym tomorrow morning. I got a little shopping to do tomorrow. Some things to return from Christmas. And I'm trying to fix the April air humidifier in my home because I don't have any, I've got radiant heat, baseboard heat, and my God, my sinuses are so terrible. It's so dry. So I'm trying to fix that. So there's a filter I need to go get and get a couple things to run around with. But I think somewhere there's got to be a bar stool somewhere with my name on it. Unless, of course, I'm here in the house, which then I'll be downstairs in the bar here, maybe a cigar in hand. I mean, I've been craving a cigar too, because I haven't had one in almost 2 weeks because of all the sinus stuff and everything that's been going on. I didn't dare smoke one. I think it would have put me into a coma. But I'm kind of craving it. I'm thinking tomorrow might do a bourbon drink, maybe do the Cedarburg cider drink and a good cigar and hunker down. I just don't know what the fare is going to be yet. Kind of mulling that over. Because if you go to the gym and you work out and then you come back and stuff your face full of, you know, pizza or something like that, it kind of defeats the purpose, you know. So I don't know.
It kind of is the purpose for me.
Well, yeah, it depends on how you look at it, I guess. Yeah.
Just so I feel better about it. Not that it actually helps.
I'm into right now. I'm kind of back into the weight loss mode. And, you know, if we're trying to put all our ducks together, and today we got a meeting with the NFL after the show, but we're trying to get our you know, details together for Super Bowl. So we're going, and you got to think, you know, you're going out to LA, you're going to the glitz and glam that is Hollywood. And while every big massive party is not necessarily going to be open the way it would have been had it been COVID free, there's still, I mean, I know they're doing cigars with the stars with Ditka and Jaworski and a bunch of the, and a bunch of the gridiron greats are going to be there. I know we've, you know, Mark Schlereth, I was talking to him the other day, and I know that there's going to be a bunch of guys over there for that one. Jay Glazer always has a big one, regardless of who covers the Super Bowl. He always has a big one for a lot of his guys. Lee Steinberg, the super agent, if you will, he always has a big one where we're talking about that. So there's some things going on that, you know, we would like to do. So you don't want to go out there just going, you know, like the big blue blob. So kind of mulling over whether or not, I should be eating any wings tomorrow or just noshing on a salad while I sit down and watch games and fill myself with cider rather than pizza sauce and such.
So yeah, I'm go in ahead. The mode right now where I go with my buddy, we play basketball for about 20 minutes. Then I go sit in the hot tub while he lifts. So it's really just the act of being in the building of the gym.
So in other words, you're just moving, which is good. I'm not going to knock you. Just movement is good. Now, when you're playing basketball, are you just shooting or are you playing? There's a difference.
Now, I'm a big off-ball movement kind of guy. Not very athletic.
What the hell does that mean?
Like I'm setting screens, you know, we're moving without
the basketball. So you're actually playing a game?
Yes. Once I have the basketball, I can't really do much, so I shoot.
Okay. So you're a chucker.
I wouldn't call it that. Have you seen Kyle Korver play basketball?
Yes.
That's what I would equate it to.
Okay. So you're running around, hand up, setting a screen, and every now and then you're going to get a chance to shoot the basketball.
And in my mind, it goes in. In real life, in high school, I would watch Kyle Korver highlights before every game to get pumped up, and then I'd play like that.
Okay.
I've lost all my game, and I have terrible knees, so.
Yeah. Boy, it's been a while since I played basketball. Back when I was doing the weight loss thing, I got a huge driveway. You haven't been to the house. I got a huge driveway. So I had a hoop outside. And literally during commercial breaks in the summertime, I would run downstairs, grab the basketball, run outside, shoot as many shots as I could, get them to, you know, if they went in, great. If they didn't, if they're bounding off the back of the rim as a brick, I'm running, I'm tracking them down, shooting again, shooting as much as I can, three, four minutes, and then back upstairs and back on the air. Sweaty, nasty, didn't matter. And then during the day, I'd always make it a point to shoot and keep moving, you know, keep trotting, keep running, you know, to kind of keep the heart rate up. And I would do that. And it was working because I was also doing biking. I was lifting. I was doing everything. But now, I don't know. I think I'd shoot a couple and then probably take the basketball and put it underneath me and sit on it for a while, breathe heavy. It's been a while. I'm so cardio out of shape. It isn't funny. But yeah, basketball is a good way to stay in shape. Now, if you're going up and down the court, the other thing is if you're only playing, how are you playing, full court or half court?
It depends on who we have. I'm also in a mode now, which I love. Back in college, whenever I would play, it'd be against 6'4 people from Wisconsin that barely missed D1. So I'd get my ass handed to me. Now I'm playing more. It's more of a men's league vibe. Okay. So we go up and down the court. We just don't go that fast.
Okay.
You know?
So in other words, it's like the people that I pass, and they're even out there today, and I God love them. But the pickleballers, the old people that are playing pickleball, they shovel the courts. They're out there just kind of a couple of trots, just you know, knocking the ball back across the net. They're playing doubles, and you got your little space you're moving in, but it's at a much, much slower pace. Okay. I can see that. Brett says, by the way, how old are you?
23.
You're 23 and you got bad knees?
Terrible. Just terrible knees.
How'd you get bad knees at the age of 23?
Good. Well, I played catcher for 10 years.
Oh, okay. That'll
do it. I told you I shattered my knee 4 years ago playing softball.
That's right.
Since then, it's just not been the same.
Yeah, I do remember that. Okay. All right. There you go. The history of one Ben Kenny and his athletic prowess. Let's do this. We're going to step away, take a quick break, come back. More of the Bill Michaels Show. More scintillating conversation like this next.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Now, in Green Bay, here's Mike Clemens.
The Packers have the weekend off. They'll be watching the wild card games to find out who they'll play next weekend here at Lambeau Field. As many as 7 players that have been on the injury list multiple weeks return to practice this week, including linebackers Za'Darius Smith and defensive back Jaire Alexander, Packers defensive end Dean Lowry.
You know, even today, seeing Z fly around and Ja and some guys that are on their way, it's been great so far. So I do think it kind of boosts team morale a little bit, and having these guys that are also great players but great locker room guys and leaders too. So it's been nice.
Za'Darius Smith had back surgery in September. How does he look? Packers defensive coordinator Joe Barry.
Matt's given the players off Saturday and Sunday, and then we'll come in with a normal work week next week. So, but at least what Z's been able to show yesterday and today, I'm excited with where he's at.
And Packers offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett has 3 interviews scheduled this weekend for head coaching jobs in Jacksonville, Denver, and the Chicago Bears. He talked about his time with the Packers the past 3 years.
A place like Green Bay, I mean, the best place in the world for football, the epitome, the epicenter of football. And to be able to work with Aaron and Devontae and Mercedes, who I had known, and Alan Lazard and all these guys, that I think that was something that we just, as we started looking at everything, we wanted to do what was best for the future and for the family. And that's why we made that decision. And it's been a pretty darn good decision here. And the amount of knowledge that I've learned is been great.
That's Nathaniel Hackett in Green Bay. I'm Mike Clemens on the Bill Michaels Show.
Good stuff. Hi, Mike. Appreciate it as always. And glad to have him back. Don't forget this portion of the program brought to you by our friends over there at New Mail Medical, treating guys with ED all over the state of Wisconsin and well beyond the borders as well. And I'll tell you right now, if you're feeling kind of sluggish, kind of moody, kind of down, pardon the pun, call our friends over there at New Mail Medical. New Mail Medical, helping you out with low testosterone, getting your energy back, getting your energy level back, getting you going. Also, the only one weight loss program works. It's fantastic. And if you're jumping into 2022 and you just want a new you, you just want to kind of get out of the doldrums, great place to go. Call them 414-455-4451. That's 414-455-4451. That is the New Mail Medical Center. Good stuff. Let's do this. Let's get back to the phone calls. Let's go to our buddy Randy to us in Grafton, Wisconsin. Randy, how you doing today, man? What's up?
Hey, Bill. Yeah, you know, when it comes to, I hear there's been a lot of discussion about what are we doing, what are we going to do to keep Aaron Rodgers. And this is not to suggest that that's a bad idea, but I'm not going to discuss it until how I see he performs in the playoffs. Is that somehow being naive or unreasonable? I understand. That I think a lot of fans, if they are honest, I think it is just about being competitive and not about being, you know, winning the Super Bowl. But I think in the course of doing that, they're unrealistic about what it might actually take. And how can you discuss it without really seeing how we perform in the playoffs?
That's a great question, and appreciate the phone call. Let me ask you a real quick in this regard. It is about being competitive because I think there was a genuine fear of going, oh my gosh, look at what's to the south of us. Look at the Bears. Look at the Lions. Look at the Vikings. You want to stay on top of the division. Okay. That I agree with. But Aaron Rodgers has been consistently successful at getting this team to NFC championship games. You're a game away from getting to a Super Bowl. And you believe that eventually you're going to bust through that ceiling with Rodgers. The question then becomes, do you continue to pound through that on that ceiling with Rodgers, or do you do it with an unknown commodity? A commodity that, for all intents and purposes, has not looked anywhere near what he needs to look to get you to that point. So do you stick with what's got you there? Or do you make the decision to say, we're going to go in a different direction. We are taking a ginormous leap of faith for a virtual unknown. And the only people that really know what the capability is are the ones that see Jordan Love behind closed doors. You have to trust in the process. You have to trust in them. But if they're doing it because of the pick and they're doing it just because of money, then you're probably not trending in the right direction. So I don't think anybody's satisfied with just getting to the postseason and above mediocrity. But I think what it is you want to continue to pound against the ceiling or bang on that door that eventually you're going to break it down time and again with Aaron Rodgers because you know that you have the capability. And finally, you've got a defense that behind him is capable of winning you a championship. Because what we've realized is Rodgers can't do it all himself. You have to have other things. You have to have other pieces. So, I mean, it's a good point. But I think it's not just settling for good but not great because he is great. I think what people are looking for is we've got greatness. Now, damn it, do enough to put greatness back into the big game. You can't – because we've learned this. You can't – how many times did Peyton Manning – he had a good defense, not a great defense. It was all about the offense, but the defense of the Patriots for years and years and years was just that good. Brady was good, but the defense was just as good. When the Steelers went there, they had a defense that was really good. When look at what Eli Manning had. He wasn't great. He had a great year, but he wasn't great. But he had a really good defense. Have they now put together enough pieces to give Rodgers the opportunity to say, okay, now we can bust down the door? Because we knew all along he was a great quarterback. But now do they have the pieces to put around him? Because if you don't have a good quarterback or a great quarterback, and you don't have a sustainable top five defense, you're not going to win a Super Bowl. It just normally doesn't happen that way. Let's go to our buddy Mike listening to us in Whitewater. Mike, how you doing, pal?
I'm good, Billy. How are you feeling?
Good. What's up?
Hey, just a back step to Greg Garden, what he went through last year with that cancer Tucker around and the uncertainty around the program and everybody transferring out. He's done a heck of a job, and in bringing that Chambliss in to help the coaching, you know, I think he could be coach of the year, what he's brought.
Oh, absolutely.
Badgers too.
That is so far in the rearview mirror. It's not even funny. And they really haven't hit adversity, but even that little skid they had over to Ohio State, and you kind of went, oh, okay, maybe there might be something. Nope, they've rebounded nicely, and everything's been fantastic ever since. Yeah, that's not even something that we're even thinking about anymore, other than just that we knew it happened last year. And then you wonder how detrimental Alano Tucker really was inside that organization for them to come out and play this way this season.
And then back at Ohio State, you had guys sick. Wall was sick.
Yep.
Finally admitted it, you know, and they were going through that. But, no, I just thought that, you know, with all they were going through, all the transfers, what they, you know, the transfers in that you really didn't know how it was going to mesh and everything. I think he's done an outstanding job to get them where they are now.
I do too. And I agree with you, Mike. And unfortunately, I got to run here, but I agree with you. Guard is going to be, if they continue to play this way, he's got to be considered for coach of the year, not just in the Big Ten, not just in the Big Ten, but I'm thinking in college basketball overall. Okay. Real quick. Let's do this real quick. Let's get to who else do we have here? Let's go to Tim in Sparta. Tim, how you doing? You're going to be the last one before the top of the hour.
I am doing well, Bill. Sorry to hear about Elmo.
No, I appreciate it.
It is losing a great friend. The one thing you don't want to have here is that Gutekunst can't have Jordan Love be his Justin Harrell. And I haven't talked to anybody or heard of anybody who thinks that Jordan Love, there's not the same buzz from when Rodgers was doing it.
Right.
The guys that I've talked to say that he has he's just not progressing. He's got all the arm in the world. He's got all this other stuff, but he's just not putting it all together. Now, that can change in a heartbeat, but the difference between the Kansas City game and the Detroit game, I didn't see any improvement. And he's been working with the ones every week that Rodgers wasn't out there with the toe. The biggest thing with Rodgers is he going to be willing to take the pay cut? And how many years is he going to be willing to do it? It's one of the things that made Tom Brady so successful, was that he's making $18 to $22 million a year. His wife's making $40 million. So he can afford the two extra or three extra defensive, you know, guys at the $3 to $5 million a year to really make him, to give him that defense that really made those Patriot teams. Mm-hmm. So is Rodgers going to be able to, is he going to want to sign a three-year deal at no more than $20 million a year? Because that's what it's going to be. And without Rodgers, you don't have Devontae Adams sticking around either. So, you know, our Green Bay Packer fans is going to be willing to take a couple of years of, well, we kind of suck right now after being really good for 20 years plus, you know, 30 years here. Because I remember back in the days when it was Tampa Bay and us to see who had the most wins in the league. And that was no fun.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I appreciate the phone call. No, that's the big question is, what are they going to do? How are they going to define the pay as to whether or not they can actually keep them around? I agree with you. Hey, coming up next, it's time. The Sauce. A.J. Dillon, running back for the Green Bay Packers, going to be joining us live and in person next on the Bill Michaels Show. We'll be right back.
This is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
It was a battle of ranked teams as number 16 Ohio State came to the Kohl Center to take on number 13 Wisconsin, as the Badgers would come away with a 78-68 victory. Johnny Davis would have a quiet night, scoring only 14 points on 4 of 8 shooting, but it would be Brad Davison's 25 and Tyler Wall's 20 that led the Badgers to victory. They now sit 14-2, 5-1 in Big Ten play, and will travel to Northwestern to face the Wildcats next Tuesday. To the NFL, the Packers just keep getting healthier before the playoffs start for them, as Whitney Mercilus was back at practice after tearing his bicep mid-November. He was there yesterday with the rest of the outside linebackers. The Packers have designated him for return from the IR. Also, fellow linebacker Zadarius Smith has been back at practice as well. Here's more from defensive coordinator Joe Barry on how Z looks.
He looks great, you know, and it's still, it's just 2 days. You know, we ran around and did some stuff yesterday. Again, we were in pads today. So I think this weekend obviously will be big for him, specifically on just how his body feels and what Z's been able to show yesterday and today. And then tomorrow, I'm excited with where he's at.
Next weekend at Lambeau, the Packers will host the lowest seed remaining.
If you're interested in a rewarding career with a strong Wisconsin company, Rural Mutual Insurance is looking to add to their growing team of successful employees and agents. Apply online today at ruralmutual.com/careers.
Rural Mutual Insurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
Giannis Antetokounmpo had his third triple-double of the season, 30 points, 12 rebounds, and 11 assists, as the Bucks would beat the Golden State Warriors 118-99 last night at the Pfizer Forum. The Deer are back in action tomorrow when they host the Raptors. For the Wisconsin Sports Zone Network, I'm Ebo.
Welcome back to the program. Glad to have you. And if you are joining us, thanks so much in this final hour of the show. Mike Clemens coming up here in just a little bit, but joining us now, running back for the Green Bay Packers, A.J. Dillon is joining us on the hotline. A.J., how you doing today?
Doing well, doing well.
Glad to have you. We're doing great. We're excited, man. Yeah, are you?
Thanks for having me.
No, thank you for coming on.
Fired up.
I was going to say, so this weekend, you're practicing, you're getting ready, you got a little bit of a bye, but there's got to be an energy going into Super Wild Card weekend and getting a chance to watch all of this football and watch this unfold and see who may or may not be coming to Green Bay, right?
Absolutely. You know, all the hard work we put on in the season, it's for sure nice to, you know, take a breath and kind of relax just a tiny bit, but we're all aware that there's still a lot more out there and a lot more to get done. So definitely got a lot of energy, looking forward to it.
With all the guys coming back this week, I mean, for this team, short of a guy like Bobby Tonyan and obviously Elgton Jenkins, but getting all of these guys back, this is the team that you were supposed to wage battle with all season long and that you felt so confident with. What is the excitement getting guys like Zadarius back on the practice field and Jair and Whitney Mercilus and your guys on the offensive line again?
You know, I think it's definitely really exciting to get them back out there. They're all leaders. All those guys are leaders on our team. Even when they weren't out there, they're still leading in the locker room and leading by example, you know, just kind of teaching us how to be pros, especially for a young guy like myself, people I definitely look up to. So to have them back out there, obviously tremendous talent and, you know, all the stuff that they can do and bringing that back in the playoffs is super exciting. And, you know, just also happy to get them back out there smiling and doing what they love to do. It's an awesome feeling.
How, and I know this question was posed to Aaron, I'll post it kind of to you. How quickly, if you get Billy back and Josh is back and David's back and you got your offensive line together, when it comes to running the football, it's a timing thing. It's when the hole opens up. Sometimes there's patience. Sometimes you got to blast through it. How difficult is it after these guys being out for so long to get that timing back for you as a running back?
You know, I don't think it's necessarily, you know, harder or anything for us. I think, you know, one thing that's really important and cool about our offensive line is, you know, I'm assuming, I don't know because I'm not in there, but I'm assuming it stems from, you know, Adam Stenovich and those guys like Billy and The way that they practice, you know, even the guys that are just coming back, the way that they practice coming off the ball really fast. So, yeah, some of those guys might have been out, might have missed some time. But one thing that doesn't change is their effort. And, you know, as a running back, that means the world to us, obviously, just so when we're out there, like you said, trying to get that timing and things like that, if there is any timing off or if they are, you know, still adjusting, it doesn't show up to us. You know, that's, once again, like I said, being a pro, that's what's great about having those guys back, and they come back and show you exactly how to get the job done at a high level.
Talking with Packers running back A.J. Dillon. Now, everybody watches you run the football and powers forward and things like that, but one of the things I noticed in your development over the last couple of years has been blitz pickup. As important as it is to run the football and hang on to the football, it's also important to protect the quarterback. You have seemingly have worked really hard on recognizing where the blitzes are coming from, where the pressure's coming from, and really getting a shoulder. It's almost like at times I've seen you take like pride in knocking somebody off to the side and not allowing them to get to Aaron.
I really have. That's one part of my game. You know, obviously at Boston College, I got to show running ability, got tons of practice at it, tons of reps, everything like that. Not running the ball, that's on tape. But obviously being a receiver out of the backfield and then being in those pass situations where I do have to pick up blocks and recognize things and things like that, I hadn't really been that exposed to. So for me, one of my biggest goals was to be an all-purpose back, an APB, if you will. And so to kind of develop that and to grow as I've been going on and continuously kind of get better each week and more comfortable, it's really something I look back on. I'm really prideful of, you know, how far I've come, but I'll also look at the tape and be like, I have so much more work to do to get where I want to get. And that standard keeps moving forward and forward until I'm always going to be my own biggest critic, but it's definitely nice to, you know, see that growth.
Coming out of that Detroit game, I've always said to win championships, you got to be good, you got to be healthy, you got to be hot, and you got to be lucky. But coming out of that game, you would say, well, they lost the last game. Maybe they're not hot. I kind of look at that last game as more of a learning moment. It's one of those things where, you know, yeah, the pressure was kind of off and such, but it seemed like there was a lot to learn. There was a lot of tape that coaches could point to and say, okay, we can't forget about this. We got to be able to do this. You know, was it one of those games where, yeah, you know, you hate to lose it, but it was a tremendous learning moment? It maybe puts the train back on the track for focus?
I definitely say, yeah, there's definitely a lot of tape that we can look at, and, you know, myself included, and where we can get better. And there's also a lot of guys who haven't gotten necessarily a bunch of time in those positions in real game reps and were able to get those reps and, you know, did some really great things and showed up, and also some things I'm sure like myself would want to have back. So I do think it was really great on that standpoint. But, you know, like Coach LaFleur said, and I'm pretty sure anybody on our team would say, you know, we went into that game wanting to win, and our standard is never to be okay with a loss. So it's not like, oh, we didn't need to win, so, oh, well, we lost. You know, it still doesn't never feel good to lose. Still not, you know, not our standard. So obviously to look at and get better and improve upon. But it was nice to see everybody just get, for the people who haven't got so much exposure to the game time, to get out there, like Patrick Taylor, get it out there, get his first touchdown, run really hard, show what he can do. It was great to see.
What's it been like for you personally this season to go through Aaron Rodgers getting the record for touchdowns, Devontae Adams getting the record for yards for reception, to see these things fall, to be a part of that excitement, obviously as the seasons go from where it was in the offseason to where it is now? What's it been like for you personally just to be a part of all of this? Do you ever get a chance to step back and just go, wow, this has been pretty fun, but just what an incredible year.
Yeah, you hit the nail right on the head with the taking a step back. I'm the type of person, the second the game ends, for the most part of the next day, like I'm already thinking of the next week. Oh, man, now we got this. What do we have? Like, I'm always thinking ahead. Or if I'm just at the house, I'm like, all right, I finished my chores, my to-do list. Now what do I have to do tomorrow? Something like you said, and it was actually my future father-in-law who pulled me aside the other day when we got this bye week. And he was like, hey, just take a second, smell the roses. Like, you guys are the number one seed. Obviously, there's still more to do, but, you know, it's pretty special to be a part of. And talking about Aaron Rodgers and Devontae, I remember it was a few weeks back, probably like middle of the season, and 12, Aaron Rodgers had, you know, broken a record. I think it was like most 300-yard yard games without a pick or something like that. Just an Aaron Rodgers like record to break, you know. Yeah. And I just remember walking over to him and I was like, you know, congratulations. I'm sure you lost track of how many records you have, but it's really cool to be a part of. And that's to answer your question. It's like really, really cool to be a part of and just being part of that history that's being written right in front of or rewritten, I guess, right in front of our eyes. And to be playing around two or plenty of, but those two that you mentioned, Devontae and Aaron, two all-time greats, not only for the Packers, but also in the NFL when it's all said and done. It's really cool. And 10-year-old me couldn't have rid up a better team, teammates to play with. So it's awesome.
When your future father-in-law pulls you aside just for a minute and gives you one of those, you know, hand on the shoulder, I would assume moments and says, you know, son, yeah. And smell the roses. Is that one where he, like, your mind's always going and you're thinking about opponents and what you got to do. Mm-hmm. And is that where you kind of looked at him and went, damn, I need to step back for a second. He's got something here.
Yeah, absolutely. It just like you said, one of those hand on the shoulder, kind of like the wise bull talking to you. And I was like, all right. And I really did take a second. And I was like, this is, like I said, this is really cool to be a part of. This is one of those kind of magical rides. And you got to enjoy it because, you know, now it's playoff time. Obviously, last year didn't go the way that we wanted to. But you got to enjoy every single second of this. And especially our mindset to, you know, go all the way this year. And it's going to be a great run. And got to enjoy this entire journey.
Now, I know COVID's been a part of this, and obviously it's created a lot of weird scenarios, but do you ever allow yourself to think, damn, we have a shot at winning a Super Bowl, hoisting a Lombardi trophy in L.A. in Hollywood? This is the end of that script that we got. Do you go that far, or do you just think, nope, whoever's coming in, that's all I'm focused on right now?
I'm not thinking about it currently. We did take a second as a team to kind of manifest and talk about that, not talk about it, but I believe it was after we got the number one seed lockdown, we all kind of got together and we're like, this is the last time we're going to talk about it. Obviously the work's to do. We're going to go week by week, put in the time, put in the hours, put in the work, but do start to kind of 12 was the one who said, just kind of put that, you know, idea that dream into your head. And imagine what it's going to be like. And I do think that that power of like visualization, manifesting, meditating on it, whatever you want to call it, I do think that kind of speaks dividends to your goals. It's one thing to say it, but if you take a second to really realize and try to draw up where you want to be, I do think that'll carry you past, you know, times where you're tired or, you know, it's too cold. But hey, this is what I want. I've seen it. I've dreamt on it. We can make this happen, or I can go one extra play, or et cetera.
So I'm going to take you forward. I'm going to put you in euphoric land. Cause mm-hmm. I'm going to say you guys win a championship. Okay. And then you come back next year and there's the ring presentation and AJ Dillon has this giant goblet of ring all over his finger. Where's the first place in Door County you're taking the ring?
AC Tap. Absolutely. Going to get some garlic parm wings at AC Tap. All I know is, obviously, I've never been part of a Super Bowl celebration. When I was at BC, the Patriots had that, and I went to high school right outside of Boston. So I went to a few Patriots parades when they were claiming the Super Bowl every other year, pretty much. And I always saw how some players would be able to bring the trophy like to wherever they were, or this guy would take it for a week here. If they let me take that trophy anywhere, I'm going to be all over Door County with the Lombardi trophy right next to me. So that'd be really funny.
That's awesome. AJ, we wish you nothing but luck, man. Thanks so much for taking time out to join us for a couple of minutes and go get him, man. We appreciate it. Okay.
Absolutely. Anytime. Thank you for having me.
All right, pal. Talk to you soon. There you go. AJ Dillon. Sauce. Going to the tap up in Door County. Good stuff. Love it. He wants to take the ring, take the trophy. He's going to eat some garlic farm wings with the trophy alongside if he gets to take the trophy up to Door County. That's fantastic. Good, good stuff. Okay. I don't know how you top that, but we're going to bring in our closer, the man that comes in and shuts the door on the rest of a Friday. Mike Clemens from NFL Sirius Radio. Mike is going to be joining us coming up next in the Bill Michael Show. Stay right where you're at.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michael Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Gina Della from Pella, Windows and Doors of Wisconsin, with today's top 10 reasons to see PellaWI.com now. Number 10.
My Pella team installs year-round.
Number 9.
Every one of our installers is Pella certified to ensure your complete satisfaction.
Number 8.
My Pella team completes installations in as little as one day.
Number 7 through 5.
A 2020 survey rated Pella Windows number 1 for highest value, highest quality, and most preferred by Green Bay and Milwaukee homeowners.
Numbers 4 and 3.
Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin has 6 lines to fit your style and financing to fit any budget.
Number 2.
Now Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin's featured offer gives you 5 years no interest plus 5 months no payment.
And the number 1 reason to see PellaWI.com now.
These offers end January 31st.
Set your free consultation today at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply. See show for details.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Thank you.
We got to put the work in. That's the bottom line. And not only that, you put the work in, then you got to go out and perform. So we know that it's not going to be easy. It never is. And we've just got to continue to take it with the same mindset, the same approach of trying to get better each and every day, taking it one day at a time, one game at a time.
One day at a time. Of the floor. Welcome back to the program. Joining us on the show. And Mike, did you get a chance to hear A.J. Dillon on with us?
I did, a little bit down the line. I just think this guy is so great. You know, first of all, he comes in with a talent. He comes in as a, you know, a hard-charging power back out of a good school, out of Boston College. Broke his leg when he was in high school, which you thought would have been a setback for colleges looking at him. And yet, you know, he overcomes that, gets to be a second-round pick, moves to Wisconsin, and then during you know, the first year of the pandemic, when there's nothing to do and he meets a girlfriend in the area, he just starts, she takes him up to see some relatives up in Door County. And this guy, I think he's like an old soul. I think he knows, hey, if I can get 3, 4, 5 years out of this, but I really like this area. And I kind of like to be one of those names up there on the wall and you know, have dinners bought for me
right.
for the rest of my life in northern Wisconsin. This is a pretty good place to settle down. And I mean, it's genuine. He's embraced Wisconsin and Door County and Green Bay and the Green Bay Packers.
So he talked a little bit about getting a lot of the guys back, Bakhtiari, Josh Myers, Billy Turner. And he said, it's just, look, they're veterans. We've been there, done that. It's like old hat. He doesn't expect them to take long to gel together. So it's going to be good news to get all those guys back on the field if indeed they can all gel relatively quick.
We've been talking about Za'Darius Smith, you know, what if, and he comes back from this back surgery this past week. He starts running drills. Jair Alexander started practice about a week and a half ago. Then he had to be put on the shelf when he tested positive. And then Josh Myers, yeah, the center, who the second-round pick, and they had him at, you know, the number one center all the way through the off-season programs and through training camp. And then, you know, he goes down. He talked about, we had a chance to talk to him about, so what's it like when these 7 or 8 veterans and, you know, power players you've got on this team are suddenly back on the practice field?
We're excited. You know, obviously, anytime we get guys who are injured and get them back healthy, it's an exciting thing, you know, whether those be starters or backups, just providing depth in the room. Very good vibe. You know, when people get hurt, you tend to not see them too much because they're rehabbing so hard all the time. So it's just good to get those faces back in the room.
Which is, you know, when you get the veterans back and guys that have been there, done that, and guys that actually, you know, with today's day and age rules, are getting a second chance at coming back and playing for a ring. So, I mean, that's a positive thing, as opposed to guys that would have normally been sitting out and their season would have been over with, Mike.
Right. And this Packers team started their season without Bakhtiari. He thought he was going to come back around the Kansas City game in mid-October. And like we talked about earlier in the week when we played the interviews with Bakhtiari, it's like just when he got on the practice field after a day or two, the swelling, after draining of the knee, things just did not feel right. And, you know, I thought a lot of these decisions were made by MRIs and x-rays. But after hearing Bakhtiari, no, a lot of it's what the player is telling, you know, the doctors and the team trainer about where the pain is, his confidence and how the thing is coming along. So then he ends up having to go back in and have his knee scoped. In the meantime, then you lose your starting center, Josh Myers, you know, about week 5 or so. That game in October down at Soldier Field against the Bears, it's the opening drive. And so this is the first time we got a chance to talk to the rookie center about how did you injure your knee against the Bears in Chicago?
Yeah, I'm not totally sure. I'm going to release exactly what happened yet with the knee. I might wait until later for that. But the good news is I felt great during Detroit. I was moving really well. And I was able to get that first half in and felt pretty good.
When he says he's going to not reveal that, my assumption is he doesn't want to tell people how it happened or what exactly happened, not to give anybody an indication that maybe they could take a little shot or maybe they could do something that would cause him to be a little weak, so to speak, I guess, Mike, right?
I think that that's saying he's not exactly 100% confident as to, he doesn't know. He hasn't played that much in a game. He played in the first half. It was great to get back into the rhythm of Aaron Rodgers' snap and cadence and those kinds of things. I also know he's a rookie. And so in the Brian Gutekunst, you know, Matt LaFleur world, it's like the less you say, the better off you are when you're at that podium. But we also know that Josh Myers, man, it must have been hurting because this is a guy who plays through pain. Remember, he played at Ohio State in that bowl game with a broken foot. And so he was asked, you know, for you to actually have to miss 10 weeks or so of the season, what was that like for you?
It's the first time I've ever missed games for an injury in my career. So mentally, it definitely took a toll. That was really hard. So that was a new experience for me and something I had to fight through for sure. And it was hard physically too. It hurt and, you know, it was a struggle to get back. But, you know, that's just kind of part of it and you accept that part of it. But the mental side of it was tough.
Which completely understand, completely get when you talk about the mental side because you're so afraid of that thing popping out or doing something on you again. And, you know, and again, Mike, I mean, they got to displace guys. They're going to move guys around. Don't get me wrong. I like the fact that you got Billy Turner practicing, that Josh Myers is back, Bakhtiari's back. You got depth in that offensive line. But, you know, it's kind of like, what are you going to do with some of these guys? Are you better off with the guys that got you there or the guys that are coming back?
Exactly. And so, you know, and talking to Josh about this, I mean, here's the rookie, the second round pick, and you know, everybody knows, okay, well, this means, you know, this was the plan to replace Corey Linsley with another Ohio State guy. But it also means that it's Lucas Patrick that helped get you there. You know, he's had these last 10 games at center. He's 29 years old. And so is that kind of awkward having to be, you know, be around Lucas now that you're suddenly popping back in there and replacing him at center?
He's been great. In my opinion, he's the example of a leader. You know, he's there for whatever I need anytime, you know, no matter the situation, whether no matter who's playing center, who's playing guard, it doesn't matter. If I have a question, he'll answer it to the best of his ability and help me as much as he can. And to me, that means everything. I talk about his journey in the NFL and how, you know, how he came in undrafted and worked his way to what he is today. I think that's extremely telling of who he is as a person. And so I honestly use that more than anything to describe Lucas.
How has Aaron Rodgers, I mean, I know that Rodgers is excited, don't get me wrong, to get his guys back. But he's got to also wonder, you know, how good are they under pressure and being able to fend? I mean, it's one thing for the Lions. It's another thing to start fending off, say, Bosa and company if the 49ers come calling or Von Miller and company if the Rams come calling. You know what I mean?
Right. And it starts with, and I know that you had that press conference on live as it was happening, you know, what about Aaron Rodgers? What about the foot? And he said, okay, I expect to be 100% by next week. It's on schedule. The bottom line was he claimed that he has not needed one of those painkiller injections into the toe, which he said hurts, for the last couple of weeks before the game. So that's a good sign there for Rodgers. You heard Matthew Stafford, by the way, he's got a toe injury, and that joke he made, like, I'm not going to show you my foot like other guys might from the Rams. Little shot there from the old NFC North rival. But, you got some breaks in the last month, right? I mean, you played the Ravens and Lamar Jackson wasn't there. And there's all those kinds of case in points where this guy was missing, that guy was, or, you know, you play the Browns and Baker Mayfield throws you four interceptions. You know, and the Browns are stupid. They don't start running Nick Chubb until the third quarter, and then he gashes you for 200 yards. So you know, there's some breaks along the way, but the Packers have found a way to win, whether it's Rasul Douglas with that pick in the clutch, you know, in Arizona against the Cardinals, all those things. You've beat three of the four teams that are in the playoffs this weekend, that one of these teams might be facing you next week at Lambeau. But like you say, you know, it was really tough to see Elgton Jenkins go down for the year with an ACL, and he'll probably take a year to come back. You know, Josh Nyman did a nice job, but he ain't Elgton Jenkins, and he's certainly not David Bakhtiari. And I watched Bakhtiari warm up in Detroit, and then, the light went bulb when I was like, oh, yeah, okay, this guy is just on a different level of quickness and with his hands, even if he could only be out there for four drives and then get fatigued. You know, he admitted I was gassed after, you know, by the end of the second quarter. But you'll go into this game with Bakhtiari and then Josh Runyon, who's been holding down left guard without Elgton Jenkins having to do left tackle and filling in. Runyon had 1,000 snaps in his second year and no penalties. So he's solid. Big Josh Myers instead of smaller Lucas Patrick in the middle of the center. And then it looks like they'll move Lucas Patrick to right guard and maybe bench Royce Newman, the rookie, who's done an okay job. He had to improve. And then right tackle, Billy Turner out there on the field for the first time this week with a knee. Is he 100%? Is he actually going to be able to play by next weekend and be in football shape? Or do you stick with Dennis Kelly? And so these are the questions that are swirling around. Marquez Valdez-Scantling not on the practice field this week with the back injury suffered against the Lions. And on defense, Shandon Sullivan left the Lions game with a knee. But Aaron was asked about that, about getting these guys back like Bakhtiari, Josh Myers, maybe Billy Turner at right tackle, or even Randall Cobb back in the lineup.
Yeah, we just got to find a way to gel. We really do. You know, we've been banged up a little bit, but we're getting Cobbie back. That seems pretty certain. Aaron Jones had the week off last week, which is great because he's such a dynamic player. You know, we still need we had some production, you know, from the tight end spot, which is great with Josiah and Daff making some plays. You know, we got to make sure that we get 83 healthy. But I like the depth that we have at offensive line. I like the way that EQ has played. He's been such an important part of what we're doing on teams and also on offense. Obviously, the unsung heroes like Big Dog, you know, A.J. Dillon, who's had such a nice year for us, Alan Lazard doing the dirty work and having a ton of, you know, production the last few weeks has been great. So we just got to put it all together. We got to be great in all three phases. You know, I think that's the only thing that's held us back over the years is, especially in some of these championship games, just, you know, not being great in all three phases, whether it's, you know, offense, myself, or defense not playing great, or teams. Obviously, we, you know, there's a couple bad memories there, but, you know, we just got to put it all together. But health-wise, man, this is amazing to be out of practice and see 55 run around and see 18 run around and 23 out there, 77. You're like, whew, feels pretty good having these guys back. Starting the excitement level definitely goes up, and the energy is right where it needs to be. So we're going to enjoy this week. We're going to rest. We're going to, you know, fine-tune a couple things and watch this weekend, figure out who we play, and then get ready for the divisional round.
Let's do this. We're going to step away, take a quick break. We got Mike Clemens with us, joining us. Our closer today, as we close things out, getting ready for the Super Wild Card weekend. And Mike is brought to you by the Bay Motel in Green Bay. Quiet, cozy, comfortable, plus the Bay Family Restaurant 7 days a week. Homestyle cooking, good stuff. Go to baymotelgreenbay.com. We're also brought to you by our friends at Quick Trip. Top-tier alternative fuels, no fee ATMs, and just an outright fantastic place to head into if you're going to be picking up some things and some beverages, maybe to sit down and watch Super Wild Card Weekend. Stay tuned. We got more of the Bill Michaels Show next.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Michaels will resume in 4 minutes.
Bill Michael in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Defense, football in general, comes down to discipline and people owning their roles. And when you aren't disciplined or you go outside the scheme, bad stuff happens. And we cannot have that. We need all 11 doing their damn job.
Got to do that job. The guy doing the job for us today, Mike Clemens of NFL Sirius Radio and our Green and Gold Insider joining us on the hotline. And Mike, the flea flickers got to the Green Bay Packers. It was something that they could put on film. It's something the coaches can point to. When we talked to, A.J. Dillon about it, he said, yeah, it's, we got to get better. We can't just sit back and say we're the number one seed. We got to get better. And that was those are some teaching moments for this team.
Bill, what happened in Detroit was important. Not that it wasn't a meaningless game or was a meaningless game for the Green Bay Packers. Or that they started putting their substitutes. They took, Aaron Rodgers and Devontae off for the second half, et cetera. They had their full defense out there. except for, you know, Devondre Campbell. By the way, named to the All-Pro today. How about
yep,
that?
Good for him.
Well, what's the reaction in Arizona? That you what? You let this guy walk, and he's now on the All-Pro team for the Packers at inside linebacker? But to me, when I think of the Super Bowl and Doug Peterson, who's now out interviewing, but, you know, the Philly special, and there's a statue of him and Nick Foles getting ready to call that play outside in Philadelphia after they won the Super Bowl, that these trick plays can happen. When I think of when you went home against the Seattle Seahawks, you know, in that NFC Championship game out there, and, you know, and Pete Carroll turned the game around after Russell Wilson's three interceptions with, what, a fake punt that worked, and then, you know, the onside kick, Brandon Bostic, these kinds of crazy plays make change careers in the postseason. So on that first trick play that the Lions ran, this is something they had run 2 weeks before in Atlanta against the Falcons, where they take number 14, Amon-Ra St. Brown, EQ's younger brother. He goes from the slot right, and he goes into the center over the A-gap, gets the football, and takes it up the middle, you know, from Jared Goff. Well, then what they did against the Packers was, instead of him running with the ball, he flips it back to his sweeping wide receiver, Tom Kennedy, who chucks it downfield to Raymond, another wide receiver, for a 75-yard, nobody-touched-him touchdown. And so St. Brown talked about that play. I got a chance to talk to those guys in the Lions after the game.
We ran against Atlanta. We ran at that play where I come across, get that handoff twice. So actually before that play that Tom Kennedy threw, I'm lined up and all I hear from the sideline is 14's getting the ball coming across, 14's getting the ball. And I'm just smiling because I already know what's about to happen. So I get the ball. I mean, give it to TK, try to protect the edge of whatever I can. And TK just throws a dime to Khalif. So it was perfect.
Well, apparently they knew it was coming and they still couldn't stop it. I mean, that's I guess the scarier thing, Mike.
Remember the play to Sir last year, just before the half, when Tom Brady comes to the line and he gets the right formation and he sees no one's paying attention to this speedy fourth or fifth wide receiver that they've got, that he blows past Kevin King and he sees a screw up in assignments and he just lost one in for, mm-hmm. for a touchdown.
Oh, we all remember it, that.
These are the assignment mistakes that I'm talking about. That why wasn't there a linebacker, a safety, or a corner that was at least holding their ground in that area? Why were they all sucked in? It's because they had seen it on tape. They had seen this play, and they thought, oh, here's where 14 goes up the middle. No, it's got a wrinkle down to it. It's going to become a pass. And so I think it's interesting to hear the Lions, St. Brown, they're saying, I could hear just before the play everybody in the sideline yelling, 14's going to get the ball, and I'm laughing because they don't know I'm going to flip it to my wide receiver, who's going to turn it into a pass. So I asked Joe Barry about this. Now, this is a long response from the Packers defensive coordinator, but this is the way this guy talks about, at least you know, Joe, that your players were watching the tape because they were shouting out 14's getting the ball.
I was one of those guys yelling that 14's going to get the ball, you know, because it was, I mean, it really was. It was great design by them. They were in what we call 0-1 personnel, which there's not even a running back on the field. You know, it's one tight end and four receivers, which you instantly think, you know, conventionally that, oh, it's going to be an empty formation. But then they were able to create a 3-by-1 formation and put a wide receiver in the backfield. And the previous times that they had ever shown that, they had just run a little, you know, counterplay handoff to 14. So we absolutely were. And that's the thing, guys, when I don't call them trick plays. I mean, it's a football play. And in football, especially defensive football, which is so reactionary, you have to apply the defensive call. You have a rule, you have a technique, based on, you know, whatever the heck you're in, whether you're in man, whether you're in zone, whether you're a 4-man rush, a 5-man rush, whatever. And you have to apply that technique and that rule, you know, once the ball snapped, you just got to react. And, they did a great job designing that play because, you know, I think that's again, why they are referred to trick plays, because, you know, what transpired, you know, 2 seconds after the ball snapped, you know, we had no idea. But that's where you have to, you know, when you play defensive football, you have to follow your rules. You have to be disciplined with your eyes, and you have to play rules football, because you have no idea. The offense knows what the play is. The defense doesn't. So it was great design. And, you know, like I said, it was, but I was one of those guys that were yelling when he heard 14's getting the ball. You know, we were all yelling it, and 14 did get the ball, but then he freaking pitched the ball. So, but no, it was a you know, you just, yeah. Yep. In those situations, when those things happen, whether it's a double pass, a reverse pass, they got us on a flea flicker late in the game. Again, you have to rely on your rules and just having disciplined eyes, you know, cause defensive football, everything's built for, if you follow your rule, you should be able to at least be in position. And they obviously got us on those two plays. You know, it was 120 yards and two touchdowns, which unfortunately ended up being the, you know, the deciding factor in the game.
Yeah. That, you know, he was one of the guys yelling and got sucked in just like everybody else did, unfortunately. And, Mike, when you talk about coordinators, this is a big week for coordinators, cause they're, you know, getting ready for their game plans of what they're going to install, maybe some things trick play wise, but they're waiting to see who their next opponent is. In the meantime, you got guys running around trying to get hired as head coaches.
Daniel Hackett, he's got three interviews going on. Luke Getsy is going to talk to the Broncos. And so I asked Nathaniel, is this a distraction, you know, preparing for interview? I mean, to me, they should be talking to head coach hires like a week before the combine, not at the start of the playoffs. And I said, so how much is this distraction for you preparing for interviews with the Jags, the Broncos, and even the Chicago Bears during playoffs?
You know, we're very lucky here right now because, you know, we don't have an opponent. So being in this situation is really a blessing. I mean, you have the opportunity to kind of look ahead and get a feel for the teams we might play. We have, you know, four people that potentially could be our opponent. So you want to try to get a beat on them and kind of do a little bit, because you don't want to do too much because you don't know what's going to happen, but just kind of get a fresh look on those guys. And then the rest of the time, I mean, we have a chance to go home, see our families. And then once the kids go to bed, have the ability to, you know, kind of review notes, like I had said before, and get ready to be able to talk with some different people.
Let's do this. We're going to step away, take a quick break. Going to wrap things up with Mike Clemens joining us on the hotline. Stay tuned. More of the Bill Michael Show. It's coming up next.
Ready? This is the Bill Michael Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Gina Della from Pella, Windows and Doors of Wisconsin, with today's top 10 reasons to see PellaWI.com now. Number 10.
My Pella team installs year-round.
Number 9.
Every one of our installers is Pella certified to ensure your complete satisfaction.
Number 8.
My Pella team completes installations in as little as one day.
Number 7 through 5.
A 2020 survey rated Pella Windows number 1 for highest value, highest quality, and most preferred by Green Bay and Milwaukee homeowners.
Numbers 4 and 3.
Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin has 6 lines to fit your style and financing to fit any budget.
Number 2.
Now Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin's featured offer gives you 5 years no interest plus 5 months no payments.
And the number 1 reason to see PellaWI.com now.
These offers end January 31st.
Set your free consultation today at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply. See show for details.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. We'll be right back. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
There's got to be an energy going into Super Wild Card Weekend and getting a chance to watch all of this football and watch this unfold and see who may or may not be coming to Green Bay, right?
Absolutely. All the hard work we put on in the season, it's for sure nice to, take a breath and kind of relax just a tiny bit, but we're all aware that there's still a lot more out there and a lot more to get done.
Welcome back to the program. Those are the words of A.J. Dillon, joined us just a little while ago. Joined us just a little while ago on the program. And as we wrap things up, Mike Clemens from NFL Sirius Radio and our Green and Gold Insider joining us on the hotline as well. And Mike, it was great to talk to him, but you've got to this week, this buildup. I know Aaron Rodgers is going to clean his house, but guys are getting work in. Guys are getting practices in. Some guys that are coming off of the IR are finally getting back out on the field. There seems to be an energy there. So, I just kind of wonder what these guys are, how calm they are, or is this the calm before the storm, or is this the calm before the focus? You know what I mean?
What was it? One of the players, well, I think it's AJ that said it too during your interview too. These guys get it that getting 13 wins a regular season is not a normal thing, particularly 2 or 3 years in a row. And there's Aaron Rodgers, and this ain't going to last forever. And then, who knows what happens in the off season? So, this is your chance in your lifetime to get a ring, and your 2 games at Lambeau away, and trying again to knock on that door to get into a Super Bowl and take on one of those AFC teams. I thought this was poignant, though. We're talking about these guys, 7 guys back on the field this week coming off of injuries. We don't know how bad the back injury is for Marquez Valdes-Scantling or the knee injury for Shandon Sullivan, although I don't think that one's serious. But I thought this was a great revealing answer from Adrian Amos, because it said, okay, so you're a pro, you've got that body clock. When you get into the season, it's like, all right, Monday and Tuesday, you feel horrible. Wednesday or Thursday, you got to get back in the practice field. And then that clock starts ticking on Friday and Saturday and then Sunday when it's go time and you're looking for a game and you're running around the field and looking to hit somebody. I said, so what is a Sunday morning like for you, Adrian, on a bye week? Are you restless? Are you looking for a game?
When I wake up, because usually before a game, I wake up in a hotel. So I know how I'm waking up with my son screaming. So I know it's not game day. But yeah, this I think this bye, you know, is good for our bodies. It's good for us learning the fundamentals, getting back to fundamentals. We can do extra stuff that you don't really get to do. But I do know a lot of times in the bye week, I want to keep moving around. I don't want to be, you know, get stiff or anything like that. Because a lot of times at the end of the year, you're working off adrenaline, your body's just still moving and stuff like that, even though you're beat up. But when you sit around, you start getting stiff, you start feeling sore even more and stuff like that. So me just keeping my body moving, you know, keeping after it, keeping, you know, things fresh in my head, fresh in my brain about plays or whatever, stuff like that. Just staying off top of it while taking care of my body. So like this week, I kept my same, you know, recovery schedule and everything like that in order to like, all right, how will my recovery be when I don't have to, you know, get in another car crash this Sunday? You know what I'm saying? I can just keep that, you know, keep that cycle. So, you know, hopefully I'll feel, you know, twice as good next week.
Mike, it was interesting when A.J. Dillon was on with us. He said right after they clinched the number one seed, A.J. Dillon said that 12, Aaron Rodgers, pulled us together, gave us the power of visualization to allow us to think about getting to a Super Bowl, described it to us. And he said, but that's the last time he said we're going to talk about it. It was so interesting. Yeah.
It was in that, you know what, the network got that overhead camera of that. And that's when that moment was. He said they had a TV timeout and they're waiting to clock the game. And that's when he told those guys that stuff. I you know, Rodgers has been pretty good, man, in terms of his leadership and the way he's working that whole organization from top to down, you know, from top to bottom on, you know, being in the right place for this run this year. So we'll see if he can, you know, run the table.
What does the weekend look like for Mike?
I'm watching all the games, man. And I'll tell you, I can't believe all the panel experts were on the NFL Network this morning and said they 4 out of 5 of them took 49ers over the Cowboys in Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
What's Jerry going to do if McCarthy is out one and done in the playoffs?
I can't
imagine.
What's
going to happen, man?
Can't imagine. Jerry will freak. I mean, I think Mike lives to fight another day down there, but I think then going into next season, it's like, okay, this is it, because we're not going to keep banging our head on that wall either. So. I think Mike is safe, but boy, this is Jerry said it's Super Bowl or bust for his team this year. So
no, but they're a dangerous team. They're a dangerous team. I think the Cardinals, they're like 1-4. So I think the Rams will take them on Monday night. But yeah, I'm watching all the games.
Yep, me too. Mike, good stuff as always, man. I appreciate it.
Have a great weekend, Billy.
All right, buddy. Talk to you soon. There you go. That's our buddy Mike Clemens. Before we get out of here, we got to do the tweet of the day, and I said this is a dynamite drop-in, but we were talking the other day yesterday about Viagra. Ben, do you want to read this, or do you want to let me read it real quick?
Oh, I got it.
Go ahead.
Some on Get Up this morning, Bart said Josh Allen, he has trouble with his toes getting too cold, so he should take Viagra for the game in order to get the blood going, like we talked about yesterday.
Yeah.
Mike McCarthy went on a local radio station and was asked about it. Mike said, I've never heard of that recommendation. I think it shows the mentality of playoff football. Whatever it takes, you got to get up as high as you can.
Mike McCarthy with a mic drop. That's fantastic. Got to get up. Got to get up and do that. Yeah, take that Viagra right there. So that's it. We're going to enjoy the games this weekend. And come Monday, we're going to talk about the Packers' next opponent, when they're going to be playing, and also we'll be back on the air in Milwaukee on Monday as well. So there you go.